This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to another sunset safari. Look at this African hippo wallowing in the mud. And of course, as you know, this is Safari Live. Again, and like I said, welcome to another sweltering day on a sunset safari. It is a ridiculous 99 degrees Fahrenheit, can you believe it? Lots of different animals lurking along the watering holes today. My name is Taylor, and on camera with me this afternoon we've got Viam. Here he is, he's putting on the lights, and now I'm blind and I can't see, but he is there. And I'm sure you've noticed my new wear at the moment. You can see my lovely plumbago earrings, which were freshly picked. Isn't that beautiful? Now we're going to see how long they're going to stick there for. But can you believe it that these funny little purple flowers that are sticky, and if you've been watching over the last few weeks, you actually would have seen James have a look at a plumbago flower under the microscope and show you all those little sticky sort of barbs, I suppose you could call them. But they're not sharp, they're nice and soft, and they just stick on the little hairs that you have all over your body. But now, when I was down in the Eastern Cape, so where I'm from, the southeast coast of South Africa, the local indigenous people there, the Xhosas, they actually use these earrings to celebrate traditional ceremonies. So weddings, engagements, you name it, birthdays, the women will decorate themselves with these lovely plumbago flowers. Earrings, they make necklaces, and all those lovely goodies. But like I said, we've got so many different animals coming around the watering hole. These zebra have already come through and had a little drink. It's been extremely hot, and thankfully the clouds are starting to come over, because I think Viam and I and Byron and Brian would have absolutely burnt to a crisp if it wasn't for the saving grace of these clouds. It has been very, very hot throughout the day. Look at that beautiful big cloud forming over there. Now, it's cooling down slightly, which is good for us. We are hoping again for some rain, but there's not enough wind just yet to sort of blow the clouds in. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that as the drive progresses, perhaps the wind is going to pick up, and with that, hopefully it blows in some big cumulonimbus clouds. Wouldn't that be lovely to see a beautiful thunderstorm brewing in the distance? That's what I'm hoping for. Now, my plan for this afternoon, I chatted a little bit about this morning, was I really want to go and check cheetah cutline to have a look, and by maybe some miracle, perhaps the cheetah brothers we saw yesterday afternoon have maybe come across to Duma. And if we don't get successful there, well, we're going to carry on around towards Biffle's Hook Dam and see perhaps if the lions are around. And I think it's just a good idea today with this heat to just keep checking all the watering holes. I think it's going to be a good spot for the animals. But let's carry on. Let's try and head towards cheetah cutline. Oops. Just trying to reverse, aren't you? Thank you so much, Jennifer. I'm very glad that you like my earrings. They are lovely. And I don't know why I haven't worn them before. Surprised. I used to wear them all the time, though I think today that they're probably going to melt away and wilt. Unfortunately, they don't like to be picked. And then with all this lovely heat, oh, I want to have a very quick look over here. There's some lovely mud. I'm going to jump out very quickly. I just want to have a feel and see how fresh this mud is that has been caked onto the tree. Let's see if it's still wet. No, I'm not sure if it's going to be. It looks relatively dry. No, you can see it's a little bit on the crusty side, but it makes sense having a watering hole right here and some mud. This makes a very, very good tree, this knobthorn over here, to rub your backs on, like the marulas. Lovely fissured bark as well. So it's really a good tree. I'm just having a look to see if there's any ticks in here, but it doesn't look like there are any parasites lurking in the mud. Perhaps they got lucky this time. No, nothing. Okay, well, I'm sure we're going to see some elephants this afternoon. I have no doubt about that. Hopefully we'll see a few splashing around. I think I've probably lost my earrings already. Oh, my goodness. Come, I've got my life support stuck on my torch, my flashlight. Right, let's carry on. Oh, hang on. I see some little birds. Let's see if... Very quickly want to show you, see if we can get a shot of those two birds. Are they going to fly away? Let's see. Okay. No. It seems as though the green wood hoopoes don't want to hang around. But I know that Byron is dying to say hello to you this afternoon. And he is also wearing a pair of plumbago earrings.
I was just looking at that now. And we too have got a hippo in the water. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Byron, and with me this afternoon on camera, we've got Brian and the Thumb. I think he's got the ninja thumb this afternoon because we had some technical issues. So to keep the gremlins away, it's great to have you with us again. And we're also sitting at one of the waterholes on Arethusa this afternoon. I've just come here. It's been a very, very hot day. And I've been hoping that we might get something coming down to drink. At the moment, we've just got this hippo down in the waterhole, really enjoying the water. There were a few oxpeckers and terrapins on his back, but they seem to have moved off. And that little bit of wind blowing through. Oh, wow, look at that. It's what we call a dust devil, or a little whirlwind that's just blowing through. It's just blowing the leaves, but you could hear it crashing through the trees. You can probably hear it now. It's going right past us. There on the water's edge. So as I was saying, this hippo's been in the water here. I was hoping to see a little bit more activity around here. There's not too much going on. We did see some Egyptian geese and a blacksmith plover that was walking on the edge of the waterhole, or blacksmith lapwing, that's the new name. But I think for this afternoon, myself and Brian are going to move around towards some different waterholes and see if we don't get some activity. Maybe a herd of elephant or buffalo or anything interesting coming down to drink. It has been really hot today after that little bit of rain that we had this morning, which was wonderful. But the skies have cleared. There are a few little clouds around, but very, very, very warm. It doesn't look like anything else is here at the moment. It's nice to see some water in Red Dam. The last time I was here, in June, it was actually dry. There was very little water down here. I think it was almost just a little mud wallow. You can see that hippo staying in the water because it obviously protects his skin a little bit and keeps him cool, even though his back is exposed. And if you look closely, what he'll probably do is roll around onto his side and onto his back and get a bit of mud on that back, and then that helps protect the skin against the harsh sun. But he's very happy in the water. There we go. You can see a little bit of mud in that protecting the back. Nice and peaceful around the waterhole. A lot of bird activity though. Right, we're going to move on and leave our hippo wallowing in this beautiful little waterhole. See what else we can find. I'm going to start heading back towards Juma actually. Like to head towards the Juma Dam. We'll take a slow drive in that direction and see if we don't have any activity around there. Who knows what else we can bump into. I know Taylor was going to see if she has any luck with those cheetah. We did get an update that we're heading in this direction or onto Juma. So if we're lucky, they might pop up. You never know what you're going to find. And especially with cheetah, they tend to move around a lot more than other predators during the day. Most of the other predators like lion and leopard, they prefer resting, especially in this heat. They'll look for shelter. We saw those lions and that leopard this morning. And I'm sure those animals have all moved into a thicket somewhere to get out of the harsh sun. cheetah tend to move around a lot more during the day, potentially looking for food that they might hunt or potential prey. But they will also go and rest a little bit at times, and I'm assuming this time of the afternoon they're probably lying down in the shade somewhere. But they would have moved around a lot further into the morning or later into the morning compared to the other cats. For those of you who missed this morning's drive, I just got back. I haven't been here for a while. It's awesome to be back and on Safari Live. And I'm here for the next two to three weeks, which is fantastic. And it's nice to meet some of the other people that I missed the first time I was here, or last time I was here rather. Like Taylor, she's new, and it's great to meet her and to be able to drive around with her. James is on leave at the moment, Brent's on leave, Jamie's just gone on leave. A well-deserved break, I think. There's a lovely little tree that I'd like to show you. We've just pulled up next to them. There's a few of them around here. If you have a look off to the left of us, these trees, this clump of trees, these are known as silver cluster leaves. And what caught my eye is you can actually see that beautiful, almost silvery color, that bright silver coloration when the sun hits those leaves. That's how they get the name silver cluster leaf. It's from that little sheen that the leaves give off in the sunlight. And these are amazing trees. They are what we call an indicator species. And what the silver cluster leaf indicates is a seep line. So what that is that you have a little bit of a crest or high-lying area, and when it rains, there's this area between the crest and the lower-lying region. And what happens is the water, as it flows down, usually gathers along the seep line. That's where the water then is pushed up to the earth's surface. So generally, it's a good sign that you should stay away from this area in the heavy rainy season, which we are approaching now. And that what's probably going to happen is it'll get very muddy around here. So we'll be very careful of driving in these areas with these trees, the silver cluster leaves, indicating the seep line. Another interesting thing, though, is the bark. And if you look closely at the stem of the tree, almost looks like you can get little strips of that bark and tear it off, and you can. And I know many years ago, locals would use the bark in making a rope. They would tear strips of the bark off, and they intertwine it and weave it together, and they would use that to make a rope. Potentially to tie down a roof of a house, or to use it to tie bales of wood or stacks of wood together if they were carrying it back to the houses, to the homesteads. So there are quite a few uses for a lot of these trees and that in the area. But that silver really caught my eye as we were driving. Now the sun is shining beautifully on those leaves. You can see that silver coloration coming through, that sheen. Brian and I were chatting earlier about the weather at the moment, and it just seems it's very, very hot, but it's quite muggy almost. It feels like it's building. It wants to start raining, and hopefully soon we'll get some serious downpours. We think possibly in about 2 or 3 days. Hey, Brian, is that right? 2 or 3 days, maybe with this heat, and then we could potentially get a nice big thunderstorm. Let's hope. There's a lovely herd of impala. So we just got a question from Kitty Kitty Bang Bang, which I assume is from Twitter. And they would like to know, with all this warm weather, and moving into summer, we're going to start seeing more reptiles. Yes, we most likely are going going to start seeing a lot more reptiles appearing shortly. Hopefully some snakes, various lizards. Kitty Kitty Bang Bang would like to see a boomslang, and I'm sure there will be a boomslang, or what is also known as a tree snake, poking its head out at some point. In the meantime, look at this impala. And we spoke about it this morning, but the little grass shoots around at the moment, which is fantastic. I think from the little bits of rain that we've had, we're getting some greenery pushing through. And these impalas, which are mixed feeders, which means they will browse off the grass, just like that one is doing there. You can just see through the grass, through the sticks. They're feeding on the green grass, a lot of nutrients, and it's all the good food that they're looking for. But they will also browse, so they'll feed off leaves, off trees, depending on the time of year and what food's around. That's one of the reasons why the impala are so successful. It's because they're able to adapt and feed on whatever is available. It's always lovely to see the impala. They're a beautiful antelope. Very dainty, I think. So we are going to leave this herd of impala, and while we do that, Taylor's got another herd for you to have a look at.
We seem to be having lots and lots of luck with the buffalo and zebras lately, and of course the buffaloes have indeed made another appearance. They're all having big conversations with each other. Isn't this lovely? You can see there's quite a few now. They're all scattered out. There seem to be quite a big group over here, all in the bushes, of course. It's very, very typical, is that no one wants to be on camera when I'm around. Why do you all hide away from me, animals? Come back out into the open. There's a couple. There's one that's not very happy, a young cow, and she's mooing away, chatting to all the other members of the herd, which is very important. And there we go. And perhaps if you are just watching for the first time and you're wondering what on earth the show is about, this is a live safari. So what you are watching now, this is happening right now in the middle of South Africa. And we are currently situated on Duma Private Game Reserve, which is in the Sabi Sand of South Africa. So basically the Greater Kruger area. And you're welcome to interact with myself and Byron this afternoon. So if you'd like to ask us any questions, you can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can even send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv, and we'd love to hear from you. We'll try and answer your questions to the absolute best of our ability. Now, it's very hot today, so you can see I'm armed with all sorts of amazing equipment to try and beat the heat, and it's also a very useful, trying to do tricks, fly swatter. Didn't work very well. I have to practice, and I'll try to do it a little bit later, but I want to say thank you. This is a present from Kirsty, and she's in final control today. So thank you, Kirsty. It's really come in handy on this very hot afternoon. But let's go up a little bit further. The buffalo seem to be moving right away from us. And Viam has given me strict instruction this afternoon. He says he wants to see some cats. Actually, he said we will see some cats. So we're on cheetah cutline now. And if you have just tuned in, we're trying to find out where those cheetah brothers have gone. Now, we had them yesterday afternoon. And we're hoping that they're going to come across to Duma and visit us. I'm not sure if they ever come this far, so perhaps we'd like to hear if you have seen the cheetah brothers as far west on Duma. It would be really nice, so you can do that by either, like I said, hashtagging on Twitter, the Safari Live, or questions@wildearth.tv. Now, I'm going to take it quite easy along this road, because I don't want to miss the cheetah tracks, of course. At the moment, I can just see lots and lots and lots of buffalo footprints, because we've just had them walk past us, and I don't think it's going to be the end of the buffaloes either. They are all around us and everywhere at the moment. Now, it's looking a bit dry and miserable at the moment. You can see that the grass, unfortunately, is starting to wither away. Animals have eaten most of it, but We've got lots of new green leaves that have just started popping out onto the trees. And I knew that Arwen was asking exactly that, saying that it doesn't look like there's very much fruit. Now, we are still in a drought. We haven't unfortunately had enough rain to declare that the drought is over. So the weather is getting hotter, the big clouds are building up, which is good for us because that means that thunderstorms are going to start brewing. And we don't need much rain. Even if we got, say, maybe 10 mils of rain, a couple of inches, we'd be very fortunate and the grass would carry on growing. It likes any amount of water and there's a little bit of it left, so it'll grow quite quickly. If you remember when we had our first rain at the end of September and I did those little segments where we stopped on quarantine open area and we took screen captures of the development of all the grass over a week. Remember how quickly it grew? The grass is amazing. But everything has eaten all the lovely green grass, which is okay. And like I said, it's perfect timing. As the grass got too short, the new leaves started developing and popping out. For everything that can digest a small amount of leaves or are browsers, more dominantly, have all started eating those. So they'll be all right. All the buffalo, the warthogs, the hippo, the elephants, they've all started to put condition on now, which is good. And I think that the little downpours that we've had over the last few weeks, I think it'll be enough just to keep them going until we get the next decent rains. They are predicting rain for tomorrow, but we will see. It's only a small percentage. It looked like 50% chance of rain. And I think if we don't get any wind, I think those chances are going to decrease because at the moment, I don't think there's enough clouds around. But we need something blown in, perhaps from the east, maybe off the coast of Mozambique, a little hurricane or something. That would be quite nice. You get a few days of rain. But not yet. But I'll be excited when that day comes when we have our first proper thunderstorm during the day. Now, you're probably looking at me and on my face how I'm getting this lovely little sweat droplets. It's extremely hot. And Neil, you're wondering what the temperature is. Neil, it's very, very, very hot. It's 99 degrees Fahrenheit. It's ridiculous. I've just spotted a giraffe up ahead. Isn't this incredible? That's nice. So we're going to see if we can get a decent view of this giraffe. Not quite a spotted cheetah, but it's got spots, I suppose. I'm going to try and sneak up to it, so I'm going to go very, very slowly. Looks like a young male giraffe. Let's see, though, how he reacts to us. I think we'll just stop over here, just for now. We'll have a little look at him like this. He seems very comfortable with us. Now, the idea about the safari is that we don't want to disturb the animals. Unfortunately, they sometimes do run away from the vehicle. And it is a young male giraffe. So I want to make sure that I don't make him too nervous. He's staring at us, which is typically what the giraffe do, being the tallest of the African creatures. You can imagine their eyesight is the best. So it's very, very difficult to sneak up to a giraffe. I don't know anybody that has ever successfully snuck up to a giraffe. Look at those lovely patterns as well. Aren't they beautiful? Now, as this male gets older and older, his color is going to start to darken. You can already see it on his legs, how the color is enhancing. And that's just typically from all the testosterone that they start to produce. I think he's probably around 10 years old. He's not particularly old. So hopefully in the next few years or so, maybe in the next 5 years, we'll really start to see a color change on him. So he won't be mating with the females just yet. He's unfortunately got to wait in line because there's other big, beautiful males around that are passing their genetics on. And off he goes. Let's see if he settles down again. If he perhaps stopped, then we'll try and reposition. But I think he's probably going further and further into the vegetation now to look for something to eat. Okay, let's see what he's going to do. Are you going to come out? No. He's going further and further. Maybe we're going to see him. might get one more snippet of him. He keeps changing direction. There he is. Oh, now you can see that wind picking up. Did you see that big gust come through and catch the leaves of all these bush willows? Now this is what I'm talking about. And as I say that, of course, the giraffe has now disappeared out of view. But let's carry on for the search of the cheetah. Or any cats would be nice, really. I wouldn't mind seeing a leopard either. Jamie was so lucky yesterday afternoon. She had two leopards. She had Shiluva as well as Karula. Now, I think Jamie may be the leopard queen. The leopard whisperer. She seems to lure them in all the time, which is quite fortunate for her. And over the last few days, I seem to be the zebra and the buffalo whisperer, which is fine. We all have to have our chances, but I'll get back to the cats again. Definitely would like to see the Nkahoots, which is our pride of lions that we see on a regular basis. Oh my goodness, I've got a roadblock now from the elephants, as you can see. So I think I'm going to have to try and navigate around this. And while I do that, let's go back to Byron and see how his afternoon is going.
Our afternoon is going really well. We haven't found too much yet, but it is a beautiful afternoon, nice and warm, and we're really enjoying being out here. It's nice that Taylor got to show you a giraffe. We're still on our journey to the waterholes. That's our game plan for this afternoon. As I mentioned, with it being so hot, I'm hoping that we get some activity, something coming down to the waterholes to drink. And we thought we heard an elephant a bit earlier breaking some branches in the distance. So Brian and I are heading into that area now, not too far from the Gallagher waterhole. Maybe we're lucky and there's something around there and there's potentially an elephant or two eating or maybe even drinking. We're just scanning still very carefully, take a nice slow drive around the area. Ah, there's something just ran across there. Two of them, two little dacre. Ah, there they go, just disappeared off there. Very, very shy little antelope. Those are two, I'm surprised we saw two of them. That's fantastic. Usually you can see one. They are generally quite solitary. You don't always see them in small groups or pairs. But nice to see two. It looked like potentially a mother and a youngster. The one did look a bit smaller. But those dacre are very shy antelope. They tend to run away very quickly. And dacre is actually an Afrikaans word which means diver. And I think it's because of the way they dive through the grass. That's how they got the name. I'm heading towards that waterhole. While I do that, Taylor's got something interesting she'd like to show you.
We've come across this lone stallion zebra who's nibbling away looking for some grass. But if you have a look on his right rump, perhaps when he turns we'll see it a bit better. There's a bit of a scrape, I suppose you could call it. Well, when he turns his rump, we'll be able to see it, but you can see those two bottom stripes where they end on the left. There's a big raw red patch. You can see he's swatting his tail quite profusely over that to try and keep the flies off of it. Now, hopefully he'll give a better view, but there we go. But I think what's happened there is I think he's been in a fight with another zebra. Now, stallions are notorious for being quite aggressive. When they do fight, they will rear up and chop with their front legs. And of course, as James has shown in the tent quite a few times, and shown you the zebra skull, their teeth are extremely sharp. So now that could either be from a kick or perhaps even a bite. Now, like I said, that could easily scrape the sort of hair right off of that. A bit nasty, but it's just one of those things. And when the stallions do fight, and it is a real fight, like I said, they go up on their back legs, and then occasionally you'll see them even going down onto their knees fighting with each other and often trying to reach around and grab some sensitive bits. That's a good way to take your opponent out, and the stallions have worked this out. But he's carried on with his afternoon. He looked like he had a slight limp as well, which is unfortunate, but it doesn't look like anything too serious. I can imagine it must just be a little bit on the sore side, but the animals are so tough and resilient that he will heal up in no time, and he won't have to lick his wounds anymore, and then he can go on and continue challenging other stallions for potential mating rights in the harems. We're still going along the cheetah cut line. We're about to come across some impala. Hello, impala. Let's see if they don't run away from us. We'll try stealth mode. I'm going to go very slowly and very quietly, and I'll pretend as though I'm driving past, and then normally they stand still. Let's see if we can get one. Mr. Male, are you going to stand still? Let's see, I think we may not. You can see he's darting off. He's obviously lost his herd, or they're all scattered out around here. And you can be a bit vulnerable being out in the wilderness all on your own. Lots of leopards, cheetah, hyenas, lions around. And this impala would make an incredibly tasty meal. Right. A couple of more impala just darting across the road. Let's see if we can get another view of them. Still checking for any footprints as we go along here, but I haven't seen anything just yet that's caught my attention. And the impala have disappeared. What a surprise. Oh, another giraffe. That's all right. Let's find a little gap. Here he is. Now, this is a different giraffe from what we saw earlier. Now, he seems to be a couple years older than the other male. Now, you're probably wondering, how on earth do I know that this is a male? Just in case you've just started watching, I will recap. You know, we've always got new people joining in on the show. So, let's start at his wonderful head. He's got a very large head. And, of course, those little things that are protruding on top of his head, those aren't actually horns. Those are called ossicone. So, it is just bone that is fused to his skull, of course. And you can see those bald patches. Now, the females don't have those bald patches. The females have got the long black tufts of hair. So that's particularly the easiest way to tell a male giraffe from a female. And then also, if you go down his neck, you can just see how lovely and muscled he is compared to that young boy that we saw. He's definitely much fitter and much darker in color. There you can see the lovely blotches have increased in a lovely sort of dark brown. Isn't that beautiful? And he's just munching away, having a grand old time, trying to evade the heat. It is quite tough when you are a tall giraffe. It's difficult to find shade. You can see at the moment he hasn't got any shade at all. He's just having lunch. I hope he's applied lots of sunscreen. No, I'm only teasing. He doesn't need any sunscreen. He's got that lovely, lovely thick skin. But let's carry on. Let's not get too distracted from our plan. I'm very good at getting distracted. I get lost all the time. No, nothing. Oh, sorry, I thought I saw something for a moment, but it was just some zebra footprints. Now, Sally, you're wondering if a giraffe could ever get aggressive with a safari vehicle. Of course, they can indeed. I've actually seen a vehicle get their door kicked in by a giraffe before. And, sometimes when you work on smaller private reserves that are not these big open systems, you know, sort of smaller, maybe only 40,000 acres or so, the animals can get a lot more habituated because you're seeing the same ones over and over again. And occasionally you have the giraffe walking right up to your vehicle, I mean literally right next to you. And of course if you get too close, their behavior can also change in a second, something like a kick, you know, and the giraffe could get a fright, and that's exactly what happened. A big male giraffe walked past and he got something, gave him a fright, and his natural instinct was to just kick and chop and then run away. Well, unfortunately the vehicle was close by and he got kicked and chopped. Oh, look, some more buffalo. See, I told you that we were going to bump into some more. And an impala. There we go. Let's have one little look at our friend the impala, who never seems to hang around. He's gone now. Yes, we always just see the bums disappearing into the bushes. But the buffalo seem to be my friend. They always seem to stare at me. Not a very nice stare. Perhaps my close encounter with that buffalo almost a week ago. Perhaps I've become one with them now and we understand each other. But this is a buffalo cow. And they look like there were a few more in the distance too. Right. I can hear something shouting in the distance. I'm going to go and investigate, but let's go back to Byron, who has got the largest African land mammal.
Yes, Taylor, we did have the largest African land mammal, and it's just disappeared. There was a beautiful elephant bull, and I think it was the one that I said we heard earlier, perhaps breaking branches. And it looks like he has already beaten us to a water hole. He's covered in mud and water. I'm going to see if I can get another view of him around the corner here. There's a giraffe. There's one or two giraffes around here too. Hang on, let's see where this elephant has gone. There he is, just through there. Through the gap. He's actually rubbing up against the tree. There he is. You can see how wet his skin is. He's definitely been mud bathing or splashing himself with water and mud, and they do that especially in the heat like this to protect their skin and help cool down. And often they'll go and rub up against trees. And I think Taylor actually showed you a mud rubbing earlier. You'll often find it on prominent trees where animals like elephant, rhino, buffalo, they'll all go and rub up against these trees, get rid of the mud and the ticks that occasionally sit on them. I'm hoping that maybe this elephant goes towards, there was a little waterhole not far from here, just at the Galago waterhole. Look at this beautiful giraffe, nice big male. Doesn't seem too fazed by us. We've seen quite a few giraffes this afternoon. We've seen two now. Taylor had two or three. So Cricket has asked us an interesting little question. And Cricket is age 7. And welcome, Cricket. So nice to have our younger viewers watching with us. And Cricket would like to know, how do the giraffes scratch their horns, or what are also known as ossicles, that bone structure on top of the head, those little horns. If they get itchy, how do they scratch them? Well, the giraffe with those very long necks, and they're able to pull their heads right back and touch the side of their body at times with those horns. So I would assume that if it was itchy, they could probably do that, or just go and use one of the trees around and rub their heads in the branches of the trees, and that would most definitely help. Looks like that elephant's coming out into the open on the other side. Let's drive around quickly and see if we can get another view of him. So thank you, Cricket, for your question. Like I said, always nice to have our young viewers watching and asking questions. Hopefully they're learning a lot. Let's have a look. Just caught a glimpse of that elephant moving through here. There he comes. Oh, wonderful. This should be lovely. Let's hope he goes to the water. It's not too far in front of him for another drink. There he comes, right out into the open. He's just stopped and he's smelling us. I just want to turn a little bit. Wonderful. There he is. Yeah, you can see covered in mud. Still quite wet. So if he has had a drink and splashed around in the water, it would be unlikely for him to go to more water. But in this heat, they'll take every opportunity. And I think this little water hole is one that we pump water to. So it's probably a little bit cleaner, some borehole water. And there we go. He's starting to drink. See how he splashes the water first. Just going to move around a little bit more, just because the sunlight is on him from the other side, and I think we'll get a lovely view if I just move a little bit further around this way and get him really drinking that water. How's that, Brian? A little bit better? There we go. Like I said, this is the little Galago waterhole. So right in front of the Galago camp. And look at this, our luck has paid off, or our persistence rather has paid off. We said we're going to go look at waterholes and hopefully find some animals drinking. And here we've got this beautiful elephant bull. It's always wonderful when a plan like this works out. I must admit that water looks very inviting at the moment. It's really hot, so I'm actually jealous of that elephant. Look how they suck up that water with their trunk. See how he splashes a little bit first, cleaning out any dirt that might be around, and then sucking up the water and putting it into the mouth to drink. And they can take anywhere between, a big male like this can probably take up to 8 or 10 liters of water and put it in the trunk and then lower it into the mouth. See how he tilts his head back slightly and lifts the trunk up? And that's just all gravity, then the water then flows through the trunk and into the mouth. They don't necessarily blow it into the mouth. So Wyatt has asked us a question about the water holes and the various water holes, and probably especially in the drought now. Wyatt would like to know is, are the animals at risk of contracting waterborne diseases? Oh, look at that beautiful Cape turtle dove in the back, wandering about on the ground. Isn't that great? The trunk in the picture and the dove in the background. So Wyatt, If there were any diseases that were left at a waterhole, perhaps an animal dying of anthrax or anything like that, yes, then animals may contract a disease like that. But at the moment, and with the waterholes being pumped on a regular basis in this dry season from boreholes, then the chances of waterborne diseases being around are very, very rare, and the animals then won't contract anything. Amazing to see that trunk work. James has asked us a question, and he'd like to know how old this elephant bull is. It's always tough to gauge the age of animals, I find. You can give it a rough estimate. But a bull this size, and judging by the size of his tusks, he looks like at least about 25 years old, I would say. Somewhere around there, maybe a bit older. He has got some indentations on the forehead, so maybe even closer to 30. The older they get, those indentations on the skull become a lot more prominent. But maybe between 25 and 30. That would be my guess. Let's see where this elephant goes. Hopefully it comes a bit closer. I do really enjoy it when the elephant come up close. Still just really smelling around. I actually think he's smelling us. He wants to see if we are a threat. Look at those huge feet. can actually see the toenails on the front of the foot. And very, very peaceful. It's lovely just sitting watching them. See how I keep smelling. Says, I would like to know, have I ever seen an elephant pushing over a tree? And yes, I have. I'll never forget when I first started guiding, I was actually, occasionally what happens is when you're training, you may shadow a more senior guide, somebody with a bit more experience, you shadow them for a little while and just see general guiding techniques and how to interpret the bush, and you learn a lot from each other. And we went on a drive once, and I was with a guide, and we had guests in the vehicle, and we got to a herd of elephant, and there was a large bull, a little bit bigger than this, roughly around the same age, and he wandered over to a tree not too far from us and lifted his trunk up. And it's actually incredible to see how they do it. But they lift their trunks up and they lean it against the tree, and they literally give it one or two rocks and they'll push the tree right over. And this elephant did that. The reason he did it was, I think, and what we noticed was all the younger elephant then came to feed on the leaves that were right at the top of the tree. But he pushed this tree over, and if we didn't reverse, we actually had to reverse very quickly. If we didn't reverse, the tree would have been pushed over right onto the bonnet of the vehicle. So it was quite a funny sighting, but incredible to see their power and the strength of an elephant. I mean, he looks so peaceful, that male. But rest assured, he's incredibly powerful and able to push over and break trees very, very easily. That was a lovely surprise. And great to see him drinking. It was perfect timing. So Milton has asked us a question. He said he has heard that elephants can store water in their throats, and is that true? Milton, I must be honest, I have never heard of that before. I'm not too sure if that is true. And if anybody else has ever heard or has got any scientific information on that, please let us know. But I've never heard of that. And from what I've seen and experienced and read, elephant don't store water in their throats or anything like that. They need to go and drink on a regular basis, and that's why they constantly go and look for water. Haven't heard of them storing any water. And as that elephant disappears, Taylor's found something very interesting for you to go and have a look at.
We found the Nkahumas. I'm so happy I could sing all day, but I don't sing as well as James, unfortunately, so I'm going to stop right there. Don't worry though, the rest of the pride is around. They're just lying in some thick stuff, but we will eventually get to them. Now, this is the youngest Nkahuma, who was mating with one of the Birmingham males, who is off into the distance, and they all seem to be giving us big yawns. They're moving from the little bit of shade that they were lying in, and now to a bigger spot. Where are you going? Perhaps she's going to go across, I think. She's going to say hello. No? Oh, that's rude. Not even a little head greet. She's going straight back to the rest of the pride. You can see her on her way. We should start to see the others soon too, and I think the youngest lioness is going to follow in the other lioness's footsteps and head the same way. Now, I think that this young lioness is perhaps coming out of estrus now, because we've got the Birmingham male who's watching in the distance, but far away you can see him. And we know over the last few days they both of the Birminghams have been hot on the heels on both amber eyes, and of course the youngest Nguhuma, but he doesn't seem too bothered by either of the ladies at the moment. So this looks like Tinyo. So on his left side of his face, he had a big scar, and you can actually see one of his canines. So Tinyo means tooth, in case you are wondering what on earth that strange word means. Now I wonder where Mfumo is, the other male who's got the big injury on his face. Perhaps he's nearby. And once this young lioness moves, we'll probably try and find our way into where the rest of the Nguhumas are, but it is quite thick in there. It's a good spot, lots of shaded trees, but so is this young lioness. Has got a nice spot, lots and lots of shade, unlike VM and I, who are baking in the sun. I hope my sunscreen works very well today, otherwise I'm going to be very sunburnt. Sounds like there's a bit of commotion happening behind us. Maybe the little cubs are just starting to wake up, but the big Birmingham is having a bit of a scratch now, and I suspect from this position he is going to come straight towards us, and we'll keep an eye on him. Having a good groom. Remember yesterday I pointed out to you how many ticks we saw on his back legs, so perhaps he's attending to that now and trying to remove some of them. It looks like it. We should see him pull a few funny faces, though, with all those barbs on their tongue that would remove the ticks straight away. But of course, they'd be in his mouth then, so perhaps he'll pull a funny face for us. You can actually see him, how he was pulling some ticks off, actually, with his teeth. You see that there? Trying to get rid of all of them. So now that he's finished mating, by the looks of it, he's actually got some time to groom himself. Hello, big boy. Just keeping a close eye out on all the lovely ladies. Melinda would like to know this afternoon, at what age do the lions start mating? Now, it depends. For a female, as young as sort of between 2 and 2.5 years old, they can come into estrus for the first time. And then for males, this is where it gets a little bit tricky. So it depends on when the males will take over a pride for the first time. They will have to fight off the resident males that are currently with a pride in order to get some mating rights. So that could be anywhere from about 4 years old if they're extremely lucky, but highly unlikely. I reckon the average age is about 5.5, 6 years old that they get their first opportunity to mate with the females. But they, of course, are in their prime of their lives, around 7, 8 years old. Well, and then after that, they seem to go into semi-retirement. They're not as fit and not as strong as they normally are, and take a little bit longer time to recover. I think let's go around. Let's actually try and reposition. Let's go have a look at the Birmingham. Let's see what he's up to. Hello, girl. Trying to squeeze past her. Now, lions are very tolerant of the vehicles. You can see she's just having a little look at us, but she's not particularly bothered. But I'll just go slowly. We're not too far away from her. She's not bothered at all. We're going to go and pay attention to the male. I'm sure you'll be happy with that. Oh, look at him. These Birminghams really are starting to look good. They're starting to look like real male lions, though they've been scarred up since the beginning, since their takeover. But they're looking much, much better. You're keeping a close eye on me today, hey friend? With him watching both VM and I as we drive along. Not that he's giving us the angry look or anything. He is extremely hot. You can see him panting away. He's gazing up to the sky there, just checking to see if there's any vulture activity. And you can see he's a young boy by his teeth. You can see that the canines are not blunt at the tip of the tooth. He is in lovely condition. And of course, here you can see that scar just above his left front canine, which is why he is called Tinyo. You're a scruffy looking thing, aren't you? I'm hoping we're going to catch them going towards Biffles or Capan at some point this afternoon to go and have a drink. I think they're going to need a drink after this hot day. I think all the animals will be slightly shell-shocked, especially since we've had much cooler weather. It just seems to spring up upon us occasionally, this hot weather. This is nice though, but a beautiful afternoon. Sorry, Louise, did you say Tanner or Hannah? I couldn't quite make out the first letter of the word you were telling me. Perfect. Had a little bit of a break up there. Now, Tanner, you're wondering, can you tell the difference between a male and a female lion track, or in fact, any of the big cats, if you can tell the difference? You can indeed. And hopefully we'll be able to find some nice tracks for you. Then I'll be able to show you. Maybe we'll find some in the mud, which will be nice then. If you look at his beautiful big paws, the male lion's track, and this goes with all the animals, is that their front feet are firstly are larger than their back footprint, and that's because all the power is in their shoulders. Now, with a male lion track, they are just as long as they are wide, whereas the females tend to have a lot more of a narrower track. The track is longer than what the width is. Now, this obviously goes for lions, and it's the same thing with leopards. Their tracks just look a little bit stockier, and the females seem to be a little bit more slight and slender. But it takes lots and lots of practice, and I think the difficult part comes in, especially with leopard tracks, when you're looking at young male leopard tracks versus female leopard tracks. Sometimes they can indeed be confusing. But that, like I said, that just takes lots and lots of practice of going out there and having a look at the different tracks. Now, with this heat today, you can imagine, as hot as this male lion is, and as much as VM and I are perspiring, I have to keep drinking water. So I'm going to take a sip because at the moment my mouth feels like a leather sandal. It is so dry. That is so much better. Now it feels as though my tongue is not going to be stuck on my palate anymore. Beautiful. Now it's quite funny to see how he doesn't really care too much for the females now. When he's not mating with them, he's quite happy to sit at a distance and watch them and not have to put up with the cubs, because of course the cubs are super fascinated by the males. They love them. But this male, we've seen time and time again, is not terribly tolerant of the cubs. Mfumo, the other male with a gash in his face, he is a lovely male lion, and out of all the lions that I've seen in the last couple of years, he seems to be the most placid with the cubs and tolerates them jumping on his back and biting at his mane and his tail. He doesn't mind too much, whereas Tinyo, he seems to swipe at them and is not reluctant to growl at them. I think the females are quite happy that he is sitting away over here. Welcome, Messias. Thank you so much for watching the show. So Messias is a new viewer. I hope you are enjoying the show so far. You want to know, why does not this lion not want to eat me? Well, he could maybe be thinking about it, but I doubt it. So the reason why he doesn't want to eat me is because I don't look like food. While I'm sitting in this vehicle, in Jigger, that's the name of this car that I am in, I look like a big rock, I suppose you could call it. And we've been interacting with these animals for over 30 years. years and getting used to them. We don't feed them, they're completely wild. So the only thing that we're doing in these cars is driving in and observing, just like what you're doing now. So as long as we don't interact with these animals on foot or try and feed them, then we are safe and we are well trained in animal behavior. So perhaps if an animal is having a bad day and they are a little bit unhappy with us, we will see those signs and we will react immediately and move away, or whatever the situation may need us to do. But we're safe here. As long as you also, you must stay seated. If you ever come on a safari, that's the most important thing, and it's what your guide will tell you, is to sit down at all times and not to break the solid silhouette of the vehicle. So don't stick your arms out, don't try and touch anything if it walks past. You can still talk, you can sneeze, you can do all those normal things, unless obviously your guide says so. So there's a few guidelines to keep you safe, and I try to obey my own guidelines, but I like to talk with my hands, so occasionally they flutter around, but he doesn't seem too bothered with that. Just having a little look over my shoulder just to see what the rest of the pride is doing. But it doesn't seem like they're doing too much, I'm afraid. You can see the movement of one of the cubs on the bottom right there, looking at us. It's too hot for them to do anything today, especially with all that hair. Now, we were looking at this beautiful male. Let's see if he's going to get up. I'm wondering now. He moved slightly, so I got excited. And Shani, you were wondering, why on earth do male lions have manes? Now, the first thing is, of course, it's sort of a dominance display, like how birds have colorful feathers or good singing voices to attract their mates. That beautiful mane is a dominance display. So you can see how it's darkening now on their chest. Hopefully he's going to get a lovely dark black mane, which is usually an indication of a good genetics. But it starts off blonde and then it edges a little bit darker. You can see the few dark sprigs coming through there. And another important thing about the mane is that it also protects vital organs. So, of course, the throat and anything else, the big back of the neck. And that's what we watch the lions do when they catch the various animals, and specifically the buffalo, is they go around and they try and grab the animal by the throat to suffocate it. That's what that mane is for. It's there to protect those vital organs for when male lions will fight each other. And that's often why when you do see two males fight, how they'll often swipe towards the rear end, because that is the next sensitive area. A claw or a paw won't go through that thick mane, as beautiful and as groomed, well-groomed as it looks. I bet you wouldn't even be able to run your fingers through that. It's just the outside that looks nice and smooth, but I reckon that it's quite matted the deeper you go inside that mane. There, yeah, he did a big sigh. I wonder what his next move is going to be. Well, we're looking at this lion panting, oh bless you, quite a bit, as he's quite hot and the others are using the shade to keep out of the heat. And Rain, aged 16, welcome Rain, wondering, can the lions ever die from the heat? Yes, and of course they can if it is too hot, and perhaps if there's no water around and they don't get to water or drink water regularly, they can indeed get heat stroke and dehydration. So it's very important that they do keep up drinking water, lay in the shade, keep out of the heat. But they are well adapted though to the varying temperatures. Let's see what he does now. I'm surprised. He's looking in good condition considering he's been mating quite frequently. Normally they lose weight drastically. I very quickly need to call the sighting in. Let me do that. They're going to quickly let everybody know that the lions are around and are here. And while I do that, let's go back across to Byron and see where he is on Juma.
That That's amazing that you got to see those lions. I'm so glad Taylor found them. Possibly the ones we heard this morning, but it sounds like they've been moving around quite a bit. But that is really great. We haven't had too much activity. We've been driving around, trying to check little water holes, little pans, but not too much at the moment. Still quite a few impala around and so on, but it's very, very hot at the moment. So a lot of animals still, I think, still enjoying the cool, the coolness of the shade. Just wanted to have a look, and I've been asking Brian about all these different pans, because they've had little bits of rain, but not much. Just wanting to know if some of them have started to fill up at all. There's a beautiful kudu. Let's walk into the sun, a beautiful female kudu. Also one of my favorite antelope. I love those big ears, and you can see while she's walking, constantly listening out very carefully. Kudu do tend to enjoy thicker areas, so they rely a lot on their hearing to listen out for any potential threat or predators. She's looks like she's by herself, which is quite strange. Usually female kudu will be in small groups or small herds, but there's possibly a few more further into the thicket that we just haven't seen yet. So there might be some others that she's following through. Maybe a male or two. Generally the males form these bachelor herds and they'll stick together. And the females and the youngsters, they'll stay in small groups. Unless the males are looking to mate, then they'll come through and look for those females. Let's carry on and have a look if there's any water here. Highly doubt it, maybe a little bit. A little bit of mud really, a bit of water. But at least there's something for the animals to drink. So Aaron would like to know my prediction for the woodlands kingfisher returning. They are summer migrants, so they come here, they arrive in summer, and they've got a beautiful call. And I understand everybody's given their predictions on when they're going to arrive, when the first ones will arrive. Sure, that's a tough one. I say, what date are we now? We're now the 22nd of October. I say the 4th of November. I don't know if anyone's taken that yet. 4th of November, I would say. Yeah, that's my guess. So David and Brian and myself are all very close, the 3rd, the 4th and the 5th. So let us see. Lovely young impala enjoying this little mud wallow over here. So there's a bit of water around, and as I said, these animals all coming down, at least there is water for them to drink. And if you have a look in the tree just off to the right of this water hole, there you can see a lovely grey go-away bird. Look at that. It used to be known as the grey lury. It is now the grey go-away bird because of the call. It sounds like it's saying go away. It's, let's see if I can do my grey go-away bird impersonation. Go away, go away. Sounds like that. Again, my bird calls are not very good, so please don't judge me on that. But just preening himself. Lovely birds, look at that crest. Now, the birds that are related to this luri or grey go-away bird are known as turacos. I actually just want to show you something in the book quickly because I find it fascinating. The grey go-away bird is not a very colourful bird, but if you have a look at, and I'll find it for you shortly, but if you have a look at all the other birds in this family, see how colourful they are. They are incredible. Let's see if you can see that there quickly. There we go. Is that right? Have a look at all those different colours. Get my hat out the way. The Shallows Turaco, the Livingston Turaco, Knysna Turaco, Ross's, the Purple Crested Turaco, which we do get in this area and in the Kruger. This little one down here with the red on the wing, we do get that around here. Beautiful colours, really green, the bright red under the wing. But compared to the grey go-away bird, the rest are very, very colourful. They get the name Turaco from the Taurasin in the, or Taurasin, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. It's the red coloration in the feathers, and that's how they get the name Turaco. But the grey go-away bird, unfortunately, just has that name. There we go, there's a little call, did you hear that? Let's see if he calls again for us. You can see he's very hot. They open their mouth and they breathe quite heavily. You see that? See how their beaks open? So within the inside of the mouth, the birds have got something known as a gular flap, and that's known as gular flutter. The trying to cool down by getting moving air over that gular flap within the beak, within the mouth, and that helps cool the body down. So the gular flutter is what birds do. You can actually see it clearly with that grey go-away bird. So Kat just sent through a comment saying she absolutely adores the grey go-away birds. Good, I'm glad, Kat, and I'm glad we got to show you a few this afternoon. Oh, there they go, flying off. There are two of them. And they've just flown off. There goes the third one. So three of them that have just flown off. That was really wonderful, lovely. Great to see them. Again, Brian's camera work is just unbelievable. The ability to follow these birds always surprises me. But Kat, I'm glad you got to see them and that they're your, or that you really adore the grey go-away birds. That was a nice little stop. It's amazing stopping, looking at impala or something small and little things start happening around you. And I think it's so important that you appreciate those little things too. You know, the bush is made up of so many various facets. Ah, and look straight ahead. We've got some buffalo wallowing. Again, these little mud wallows are wonderful animals. Look at that. There we go, two buffalo. See, so animals like the buffalo, the elephant, as I mentioned earlier, they roll in the mud and they like these mud wallows so that they can cool down. Helps protect the skin from ticks and that too, and fleas. It's a little mud bath in the afternoon. It's perfect to cool down. And these older buffalo, like that one over there, looks much older. It's got quite a thick boss, or that middle horn structure is known as a boss. And that's generally a good sign that it's an old one, if they've got a thick boss like that. And look at that, you can see it's quite old. So these buffalo bulls often form small bachelor groups They don't really like to move around as much. And there you can see, look at all that mud on him. He may just change direction. But these buffalo bulls form these small bachelor groups. You might find one by himself, or you get anywhere between 2 or 15 I've seen together. They don't like to move around as much, so they'll find an area where there's good vegetation to feed on and water, and usually mud wallows, just like this one. And they tend to hang around there. The reason for that is they don't, the large herds of buffalo, with all the females and the youngsters, they cover huge distances, constantly just looking for food and water. And these males don't like doing that anymore, so they generally split away from the herd, find these areas that they can relax in, and then at a later stage, if the herds do pass through again, possibly join up and try and mate with females. But these water holes are fantastic. And they are known as, or they've got a nickname, these buffalo bulls, called Dugger Boys. And Dugger comes from the Zulu word, Mdaga, which is mud. And it's because they're constantly wallowing in mud, and that's how they got the name Dugger Boys. So mud boys. These big bulls wallowing around, lazing about in the mud. But I must admit, if you had to ask me, probably one of the animals I would least like to walk into while on a bushwalk in the bush, because they tend to be quite unpredictable. So even though they look quite relaxed, if you're on foot and you bump into some of these, it can sometimes be unpleasant. I think, as Taylor was saying earlier, it's very hot and her mouth is dry. Mine too. So Milton has asked us a question about the white spot under the buffalo's eyes and what it is. And some seem to have them and some don't. Milton, I think it's just the eye. Just like we get what we call sleep, or residue that forms on the edge of your eye after you've been sleeping. The same thing with buffalo, they get liquid and residue forming around the eye. And I think possibly also from flies irritating the eyes a little bit, they weep a little bit more, and that's all that is around the eye. So some will have it, some don't. They may get rubbed off. It's right in the eye there. That other little white spot that we can see on the face of that buffalo is probably just from the flies and fleas around the face. It can also be from ticks and fleas. They eat away at some of the hair around the face of the buffalo, but that's more on the nostrils or on the face, not up close to the eyes. Got a comment from Haley saying that perhaps the Nkuhuma pride might come past you later at some point and find these two buffalo. That would be interesting. Another buffalo meal for them. I think they're probably still reasonably full from the buffalo they finished last night. There you go. These guys are heading straight over towards us. So Shani, who's a new viewer, so welcome Shani, lovely to have you with us. And Shani would like to know is, do the female buffalo also have horns, or is it only the males? Well Shani, I've just had a look at this buffalo that's walked, or these two that have walked out from that mud wallow, and the one on the right that is actually going down into that little ditch now, that one, that is a female. Her horns are much thinner than the males behind her. That little boss or that section on the front of it, you see that? There's actually a bit of a gap between the horns. And if you look at that big male, there is a bit of a gap, but look how thick that boss is. So immediately you can tell that it's a male and female. That female's horns much, much thinner and smaller compared to the male's. they go. Possibly just heading across to the other mud wallow, from one mud wallow to the next. It's interesting just to see a male and female alone together like this. As I mentioned, usually you'll get males together, but it's not uncommon. I mean, it's, again, there's never a guarantee in the bush, and there's never a set certainty of which animals move around together. You can get a male by himself, you can get females by themselves, or mixing two like this, and together they're also a bit safer, so that's why they prefer to stay together. That female at the back does look very, very thin. Looks like the drought has affected her quite badly. Look at that. You can see the ribs and the pelvis rather standing out very, very clearly. All right, well, they're heading off. Let us continue and see what else we can find. But that's great. So far, our luck with checking water holes this afternoon, or our plan rather, with checking water holes, has worked out nicely. Seen some interesting things. Buffalo in the mud, elephant drinking. So there's a lot going on. Now all we need is a leopard coming down to drink. Wouldn't that be great? And we were speaking about the Unkuhuma pride earlier, saying I wonder if they'll meet up with these buffaloes or find these buffalo. But Taylor's actually sitting with them at the moment, so go ahead and see what they're up to.
We're watching the lion cubs fast asleep now, though. As I say that, one of the lionesses rolls over onto her belly. That seems to be a popular position today. And look how she's giving herself a little scratch. That's quite nice. I find it so funny how all the Nkuhumas seem to love to rub their bellies with their own paws. I've never seen it before until I came across the beautiful Nkuhumas. You can see all the little cubs, though, are absolutely exhausted. They've had a long day by the sounds of it, and they look very tired, panting away, trying to beat the heat of the day, which is, of course, I think, quite difficult when you are covered with all that hair. That one must be very hot with the sun baking down on it. Here we go, you can see how quickly it's breathing. A little bit of movement, but not too much from them. I think, though, that they're going to sleep for most of the afternoon. I think it's only going to cool down much later this evening, unfortunately. Now, we aren't going to be able to stay with Nkuhumas for too long. Kitty Kitty Bang Bang, I absolutely love your username, it's incredible. You'd like to know, can they sweat through the pores of their pad? Yes, they can. They can indeed do so, that's one of the perks. And another animal that does it quite well is the rock hyrax, or a dussy as they're commonly called in South Africa. And I suppose for the hyraxes, though, it's a little bit more difficult because they tend to lose quite a bit of heat through the pores of their pad as well. And I don't think they're as fluffy, though, as the lions. They have to rely on cuddling up to each other to keep warm, where we often see the lions getting quite annoyed with each other when they sit on top of each other. Well, the cubs don't mind. The cubs just do whatever they like, really. Including putting a foot in mom's face, as you just saw. But like I said, unfortunately, there are lots of vehicles that want to come and see the lions this afternoon. And I don't think that they're going to do too much, though, but I will keep listening out to the radio that perhaps if they do get up and start doing something interesting, and maybe once everyone has come through, maybe we'll be able to come back. But it is only fair that we give everybody a chance to come and have a look at these incredible lions. You can see why everybody wants to see them. At the moment, I wish I could cool down from the padding under my feet. I am very hot this afternoon. I feel like I may go and put my feet in the water and join Henry the hippo. Perhaps he wouldn't mind some company. Oh, look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Now look at the size of the paws of the adult lioness compared to this young cub. And it's hard to believe that in a few years' time, maybe even in a year and a half, he'll be almost just as big as Mom. And they're fast asleep. Look at that one, fast asleep, huddled right underneath that tree. If it wasn't breathing so quickly, you would actually think it was dead. Now, Tim Silver wants to know, how long do I think the Birminghams have got to rain? I think they've got a few more years in them, seeing as they've just sort of come in last year, and they're almost 6 years old, I suspect. Also, it depends on if there's a bigger coalition that comes through, possibly, maybe from Kruger, maybe from the Manuleti, from the Timbavati. They could be taken out at any moment. I think they're going to be here for maybe another 2 years or so. I think they're going to be great. Now, it is very difficult, of course, with the Birminghams, how they have split up quite a bit. We normally just see Tinyo and Mfumo together occasionally, every now and then. Nena comes through as well, but I have yet to see all four Birminghams together, which I'd absolutely love to see. So that runs a risk, is that if three new lions come in, a new coalition comes in, they'll just take the Birminghams out one at a time. And that's the problem when you don't stick together. Fast asleep, it's very uncomfortable. Now, I'm sure you remember that the Birminghams used to be five strong in the coalition, and unfortunately, the fifth Birmingham, who I believe was an amazing character and was one of the most of the favourites of the team from Wild Earth. And I know that Kay Williams was wondering exactly that. Where did he disappear to? Now, from what I've heard, unfortunately, he succumbed to some injuries that he sustained from a buffalo. And that's what happens when you want to take on one of the toughest creatures in Africa. As a lion, you can easily fall victim yourself. Oh, big stretch, but unfortunately I don't think anything promising. I don't think that they're going to wake up. Right, I think what we're going to have to do now is there's lots of other vehicles itching to get into the sighting, and I can hear the vehicles rumbling in the distance waiting to head in. I think we're going to have to move out of the sighting. Like I said, if I hear that they do perhaps wake up and start to do something interesting, well, I'll be the first one on that radio to try and get us back into that sighting. Now, we're not going to go too far. What I'd really like to do is go back down the cut line and have a look if that beautiful leopardess is perhaps still around. Now I need to do a bit of navigating. Let's go back to Byron and see if he's got any more buffalo or elephants.
Unfortunately not, Taylor. No more buffalo or elephant just yet, but you never know, we might be able to find something soon. Sounds like those lions are resting. It's still very, very warm, and I think because their bellies are still probably full from last night, there's no need for them to move anytime soon. So I think they'll still rest for quite a while until it cools down a bit, and then probably move around a little bit later. We're heading towards Biffles Hook Dam and going to see if we can find anything popping out there. Some impala around here and a waterbuck. Let's see, and a zebra. So, yeah, there's a water buck hiding through there. And then there is also a zebra out to the left. Exactly there. In the thicket, there's a zebra. And it was moving from left to right, so it might come into our view. There we go. You can just see that zebra moving through there. I mean, it is very tricky to spot some of these animals at times. There we have the water buck and zebra. And it looks like, again, this bit of green, or this greenery coming through, these green grass shoots. That's exactly what these animals are feeding on. And that's why you often get different species in the same area. The zebra, the water buck, and there's some impala moving through here too. It's because they're all feeding on the same vegetation. So they don't mind hanging around together. The other thing is that they'll warn each other if there are any potential predators around. So for safety, it makes sense for a lot of the herbivores to move around within the same area. And it's a bit thick through there, so let's carry on. Saw some impala moving up just ahead off to the left of the road, but let's stick to our plan and head towards Biffleshoek Dam. Let's see if there's any activity around there. I can definitely see a change in the last month. There, all the impala. So I can just see a lovely change in the vegetation over the last month. The greenery is coming through, so it's changing. We just need more rain. We need rain for the regrowth to really come through. Just something interesting I'd like to show you, and I'm sure some of you have seen this before. Let me just jump off here and move over to the right. Show you what. Oh, it's actually an excuse just to stretch my legs a little bit. But have a look over here. Look how this tree has been damaged by elephant. And what they've done is they've stripped the bark off almost, they have right around the tree. And that's a problem for this tree. This is a beautiful marula. And what's going to happen now is this tree is probably going to die, because this bark, and if I'll show you over here, with the inside layer of the bark, just make sure there are no scorpions around, but the inside layer of bark contains a cambium layer. Now that layer is what transports the nutrients from the roots to the tree and from the tree further down. So with this bark being stripped off completely around, then the cambium layer is then pulled off, and the tree has got no way to transport those nutrients. So that will cause this tree to die. But you can see how the elephant has used its tusks, scraping up against the side of the tree here. And what they do is they stick the tusk in, they pull the bark off, and then they use their trunks to strip it. And this one's been stripped quite a bit, and they feed on that on the bark because of that that very nutritious cambium layer. A lot of nutrients in there for the elephant. Oh, it is good to stretch the legs a little bit. Just jump in and plug in again. And there's another sign of an elephant straight ahead. This elephant has pushed over this tree right into the road. We'll have to clear that at some point. So, James Bay, thank you very much for your comments and for your question. It's great to be back. James Bay would like to know if I can point out some more trees with medicinal uses this afternoon. Firstly, well, it's not quite medicinal, but this beautiful marula tree and the tree that we were just speaking about, the marula tree, and hopefully soon we're going to start, probably December, The marula tree bears beautiful fruit, and the marula fruit is great to eat. And as, like I said, not quite medicinal, but it is very important. If we can eat it, the animals love it. Elephant especially love feeding on marula fruit, but it's very rich in vitamin C. So if we ever stuck out in the bush, and I know we will be doing it while we're here, is we'll definitely pick up some of the fruit and eat the fruit while we're on drive. It's really great. It's a little sour, but very rich in vitamin C. So lovely to feed on or to eat. For the animals to feed on, for us to eat. This is a nice tree that I would like to show you. Just trying to see if I can see any little knobs on the... This is quite an old one, so a few around. It's a bit tricky to see, but this is known as a knob thorn. It is an acacia tree, and there you can actually see on that branch. There we go. You can see those little knobs or nodules coming out of the tree. And this is known as I said, the knob thorn or the acacia tree. Now, traditionally, some of the tribes within these areas, they believe that the knobs or nodes, if you cut them off, they are used to help cure toothache. You would chew on that knob, put it in your mouth or around the infected tooth, and that would help cure toothache. I haven't tried it, but it is something that I've heard a number of people or locals speak about, and so they did use it when they were younger. So that's interesting, and that's the knob thorn. Definitely try to do some more trees. We spoke about the silver cluster leaf earlier. They're able to strip the bark off and wind or twine the bark together to make a rope. They would use that to tie things together or tie roofs, especially thatch. You know, tying thatch together, they would use that as a roof. Tying mud or blocks of mud that they would pack, they would use the wood and the rope just to stabilize it a little bit for their homes. All of that traditionally used for housing in these areas. Looks like we have some zebra up ahead. Zebra and impala. It's actually a lovely temperature right now. The temperature's dropped slightly. There's something over there. Oh, and buffalo. Fantastic. I was about to say, I'm sure I can smell buffalo. There's a sign of buffalo back there, a lot of dung and that. And there's a great herd of buffalo moving through this area with the zebra. And again, I think it's probably because of a bit of green vegetation around here. This was a nice surprise. Let me just move forward slightly for us. I think we might get a better view through there. And of the zebra. It's really wonderful to see different species. I mean, we've been lucky just along this road. Now, we saw a kudu earlier while you were watching the lions. We saw kudu. We saw the waterbuck. We saw zebra, buffalo, impala. And there's a lot of different general game in this area, which is great. It's wonderful to see these different species around. You see those zebra really searching for that green grass that I spoke about. Now, It looks like a reasonably large herd of buffalo. They've spread out quite a bit. There's quite a few up ahead too. So all these animals enjoying whatever little vegetation they can find. And there we go, you can see the horns of that buffalo. Any guesses quickly on what you think, male or female? I hope you're all shouting at your computer screens, but that is a female. You can see very thin boss, or almost no boss at all. But there's a horn structure there, just not nearly as thick as the males. You can see that clearly. And then if we go off to the right a little bit, just down there, look at that thick boss on that male. See, very, very different. Thanks, Brian. See, I wonder, their general direction seems to be towards Biffles Hook Dam. They are still quite a distance away from there, and so are we. But we are still going to be heading in that direction to see if there's anything that's come down to drink. And I would assume that these buffalo at some point may wander down there, because it is a nice prominent water source in this area at the moment. So a bit later they could possibly head down, go for a drink and move off again. Or they may even have drunk earlier today and they're still moving around feeding. Lovely just listening, and I don't know if you can hear very clearly, but you just hear the leaves and the branches moving as these animals are feeding around us. Every now and then a little snort from a buffalo. Well, I think let's leave this herd, let them continue feeding. And while we do that, we're going to continue making our way towards Biffles Hook Dam, see what's around there. It's probably a bit cooler and closer to the water. Still this beautiful zebra in the road ahead of us. And this afternoon light, you know, we spoke about it this morning in photography, and I really enjoy photography. And these golden hours, the morning and the afternoons, especially afternoons, this is perfect for photographing animals. You just get such beautiful natural light on them. You really don't need to adjust your camera or worry about changing settings too much on your camera for photographs like this. While we carry on to Biffles Hook Dam, Taylor's got another cat for you. I can't believe it.
Now you're just going to see Shaluva disappearing into the distance. She's moving further and further off the road, but we're going to see if we can get a gap. I'm going to keep rolling backwards and perhaps we will see her again. Let's just see where she's gone. Can you still see her, VM? I've lost her now. She's gone to the termite mound. You can see her there. Let's see where she's going to go. Okay, she's going to have a little rest over there. Unfortunately, this is the best view that we can get you. And she is probably about 80 meters or so, maybe not quite 80 meters, but almost that, off the road now. And unfortunately, we don't have traversing rights in Biffles Hook. So she's just sitting. I think the sun was getting to her. So she's changing position. You can even see that she is panting quite quickly. Now, I've never seen this leopardess before. She looks quite beautiful, though I haven't really had a great look at her yet. But I believe she is an absolute stunner and an older girl, which is quite nice. I think around the same age as Karula, about 11, born in 2005. So that's quite nice. Now, because I'm new and I'm still learning about the history of all the different cats in the northern Sabi sand, maybe you could help me out. I have a notebook which I write the sort of bloodlines, the family trees of all the different cats, and I don't know anything about Shaluva besides her age. So maybe you could tell me who her mother is. Perhaps you could tell me if she's had any cubs and who they are, or if she's been mating with anybody recently. And you can do that by either hashtagging Safari Life, or you could even send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv, and I would really, really appreciate if you could give me a little bit of a hand here. Now, I know it's quite obstructed, but maybe she decides to get up and move around again. It seems to be a tricky position even for the rangers that are able to drive on Biffle's hook. It's quite dense where she is laying, and it's making it very difficult to get a decent view. You can see all those bush willows and terminalias. Wonderful. It's going to be very, very tricky, unfortunately, to have a look at this leopard. Oh. Ah, thanks, Ellen. Sorry, Ellen Fowler just let me know that Karila was actually born in 2004. I'm just a year off. She's a little bit younger. I just want to move forward slightly. There's just lots and lots of vehicles coming in and out of this sighting. Now, hopefully we'll be able to get a better view. Let's check a little bit further ahead if we can perhaps get another glimpse of her. Oh, let me just move off the road completely, as I think this vehicle is going exactly the same way that we are going. So let's let them go past us, and then we will carry on. We will reverse and we will try and see if we can get another look at that leopardess. All right, let's reverse. Hello. And let's try this again. Let's see if we can maybe get a view from up here. I'm just going to look over my shoulder to see if I can spot a gap. But it is quite difficult. Right, let's go back slowly. I'm going to have another little look here. Liam, where were we? Were we up a bit further? It's proving very tricky. Can you see her through there? It's very, very thick, the angle that she is sitting on that termite mound. Liam, where exactly were we? Were we here? Just trying to find the same spot. It's very, very difficult, I'm afraid, to try and get the exact angle as where she was sitting. Let's see. Here you can get a little glimpse of her. Now, we have been so spoilt over the last few weeks to always have the best sightings of the different animals, the leopards, the lions. We've always had a clear view, but it seems as though luck is just not on our side. But it's a small price to pay. Everybody's repositioning. I think we're actually going to have to leave this sighting. It's getting very, very busy from a variety. Oh my goodness. Right. Unfortunately, I think we're going to have to call it quits with that sighting. It's just too difficult for us to keep a view. There's too many vehicles moving around, and we keep getting our picture cut off. So we'll try again a little bit later. Let's carry on, though. And thanks so much, James Richard, who said that this is Nkanyeni, another leopardess I haven't seen. It's her sister. And apparently, Shiluva has been seen mating with Mvula. So thank you very much for all that information. I'm going to have to jot that down into my a trusty notebook, which is full of all sorts of secrets and random things. And I apologize that sighting of Shiluva was cut so short. It's very, very difficult to try and get a view. But like like I said, I'll keep listening out to perhaps see if anybody gives an update on her movements. Maybe she comes back to her original position, which will be much easier. But that's okay. We'll just have to try and find something else in the meantime. And I'm so happy to say that it is finally cooling down and it feels amazing. It is lovely, the wind on my skin through my lovely cotton shirt. It's cooling us both, Viam and I, down very nicely. And I think we're going to have a spectacular sunset tonight. There's a few clouds forming in the distance, but not too many. And I think they will light up with different shades of purples and blues and reds and oranges and all those fantastic colors. But we will carry on. Maybe what we can even go and do, Viam, do you want to go and look for Karula? VM says yebo, which means yes in a local South African word. We South Africans are strange creatures. We don't use anything, any words that anybody else uses in the rest of the world. So I think we'll do that. We'll go down towards where Jamie had Karula last, and perhaps in the last 24 hours she has made a kill, and maybe the cubs will be around. I expect it's not going to be easy though. She never makes it easy unless you just stumble across her, but it is quite difficult to track Karula. I've watched how she zigzags in and out of drainages, confusing even the best of trackers. Right, let's carry on through here and see what else is lurking in the bushes. Doesn't seem like too much. I think what we might actually even go and do is check one or two watering holes now that the sun is about to drop as well. Perhaps we'll get a whole new flush of animals coming through. So maybe we will go and have a look at the dam cam at the pan where the dam is. Sorry, at Gowrie Dam, and have a little look around there. Oh, hello, Impala. No, every time I say hello to them. Now, the Impala never seemed to want to stand still. Every time I say hello to them, they look at me and they race off. Oh, she's looking a little bit on the thin side, unfortunately. That looks a little bit better. Now, Heidi, you are wondering, what leopards haven't I seen? Oh, my goodness, there's so many. I'm absolutely itching to see, of course, Nkanyeni. I've only heard good things about her. I'd love to see Quarantine and, of course, the Anderson male, so I can compare him and Mbavala for myself and see who is actually the biggest, because I don't know if anybody out of Brent, out of Jamie, out of James, and perhaps even out of Byron. I don't think any of them have actually seen Mbavala, possibly just photos. Now, I've seen Mbavala for a few times, so I'll be able to put the myth as to who is the biggest of the two, because photos really don't do it justice. But we'll be fair, we'll make sure when I see the Anderson, he has to have a full belly so he can look as big as he's possibly could be. Who else haven't I seen? There's so many. I haven't seen Tandy and her little cubs. I've just obviously seen lots of photos and lots of footage of her in the past few weeks. We were very lucky. And I think that's it. I'm probably missing quite a few. I wouldn't put that past my goldfish memory that I have occasionally. It comes through. But those are the leopards that I'm most excited to see, and I'm glad to have had a quick little snippet I've gone all tongue-tied now, Shiluva, and hopefully we'll be able to get a better sighting of her at some point too. Now, I'm not sure where the closest water is. I think it is Tamboerti Dam in Biffles Hook, so I don't know if she's going to come across and drink on our side on Duma. I think she's going to stay, unfortunately, put on Biffles Hook's traverse. Oh, and of course we've got another roadblock from the elephants. What a surprise. And I say that with great sarcasm, of course, because that seems to be what we are seeing over the last few weeks, is just plenty of trees being pushed over by the elephants. But it's all for good use. They're eating them, at least. They're not just pushing them over for fun. They're actually making use of them. What else have we got going on here? Oh, look at this lovely tree, wisteria, that we've got over here. Isn't it beautiful? It's quite a tall one. See, it's nice to see that it hasn't been attacked by the elephants and dwarfed. Now, I'm wondering when we're going to start to see the beautiful purple flowers that this tree has to bear. I know a few weeks ago, just before I went on my vacation, we found a tree wisteria with lovely purple flowers. And if you're wondering why on earth does this one not have flowers, if we have already seen one, it depends on the types of soils that are below and in the soil around the trees, of course. Some of them may be a little bit more nutrient-rich than others. Others may be growing in poorer soils. But it's a lovely tree nonetheless. Another tree that I'm quite excited about that has got its flowers at the moment, and maybe we'll try and find one if we go and visit quarantine, is the apple leaves, the Phalaenoptera violaceae. Now, they've also got lovely purple flowers. So perhaps when we make our way towards quarantine to head to where Karula was last seen, I'll be able to show you that beautiful tree, which is one of my favorite trees. It is quite pretty. It's a good climbing tree as well. Sometimes let me put my foot to the pedal. I believe that a few of you have said that there are lots of elephants at the dam camp. Well, let's not waste any time then. I will tell you a little bit more about the tree. But first, let's race on over and see if we can catch those elephants. Ah. Well, we'll go and have a look at the dam and see if there's anything there. I'm going to go a little bit quicker than my normal snail pace that I tend to drive. You can see lots of elephant footprints around here. Okay, so I believe that the dam cam is actually being fixed. Thank goodness Connor is back from his vacation and he has been put straight to work. He's just got off a plane from Cape Town and they've got the whip cracking and getting him straight to work even though the sun is just about to go down. But let's go and have a look anyway. Racing around here, and of course as we're driving I am keeping my eyes peeled. I still think that's one of the most important things, is if you are going to drive a little bit quicker than normal, you must keep an extra eye out so that you don't get in the way of a zebra or an impala racing across the road. Now, while I make my way towards the Gowrie Dam and have a look what's going on, let's go back to Byron and see how his afternoon is treating him.
Taylor, I'm not up to anything, unfortunately. We haven't seen anything again. We went past Biffleshoek Dam, and it is so dry at the moment. We really didn't see much. There was that hippo that I think you saw earlier, and that was about it. So we have decided to keep cruising through the bush and hoping that we bump into something interesting and exciting. You know, both Taylor and I have said that it's cooled down and started to cool down quite a bit, so we might get some activity, you never know. So let's just have a good look while we're driving. Best time of the day these afternoons. See, there's some cicada bugs calling around us. It's always also a sign of summer, you know, all the cicadas start coming out. Let's see if I can just move this branch out the way. Oh, I don't think. There we go. So Kathy from Tennessee has asked me what my favorite bird is, and Kathy says her favorite is a bateleur. And Kathy, I must agree that the bateleur is a beautiful bird. I love seeing them, but my favorite bird is also an eagle. It's the Marshall Eagle. Ah, oh, it's such an incredible bird. Very powerful, very graceful, And I really love them. Love the colors and the markings on the body. So the Marshall Eagle. It's spelt M-A-R-T-I-A-L, martial, not martial as in martial law, but martial, M-A-R-T-I-A-L, and very, very beautiful bird, if you would like to look it up. Some old elephant tracks along the road, they don't look too fresh, looks like vehicles have driven over them. Starting to lose a bit of the sun at the moment behind the clouds. What's the time? Yeah, usually this is a nice time to stop for sundowners. And don't know, those of you around the world, if it's that time for you, maybe get yourself a good sundowner and enjoy the afternoon with us. Well, grey go-away bird. Oh, come on, I saw you guys earlier. And I hope you stay there. There we go, some dwarf mongoose. Just off. Here we go. Oh, nice. They're quite relaxed out foraging. There's quite a few of them. They're very gregarious, as I mentioned earlier, always in big family groups. But how cute are they? They are beautiful. And they're tiny, tiny little mongoose. The smallest mongoose in Africa. Look at that. Foraging for food, and they'll feed on mostly insects. These little dwarf mongoose mainly feed on insects. There's a few more running around. There's a tree squirrel. There we go. Looks like he's got something to eat. That's the little squirrel. And let's just see more of those dwarf mongoose. It's amazing how quickly they can disappear. Looks like they've just moved off, but what a nice little surprise. Always really wonderful to see these little creatures foraging for food during the day. Let's continue. I was just, or I say just about, what was it, about 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks, I was in the Kalahari with some guests, and there's another mongoose species around there. Well, I say mongoose, it's part of the mongoose family. They are the meerkats or suricat, and they really are fascinating little creatures too. The meerkats, and in one of the areas that we go to, you're actually able to walk with them and follow them. They've been habituated to people, so they're not too skittish. And they allow us to follow them around. You don't touch them or anything, but you can view them from a few meters away. And you watch how these animals, these little creatures, go and look for food and forage and dig up grubs, and something that's really fascinating, the little scorpions. Amazing how they're able to dig down and find these scorpions. Sometimes almost 30 centimeters under the ground. Ah, oh, beautiful giraffe. I'm just going to go this way. Hold on. And these meerkats wander around foraging for food and digging up all these creatures. It's incredible to see. Nice giraffe. Can see the hooves of the giraffe very clearly there. Very large hooves. Even-toed ungulate, which means they are herbivores, and they've got and even toes, obviously the two toes, the split hoof, and that's an order that they fall under. Just looking at the sunlight that we've got now, and with this giraffe feeding, it's always wonderful to try and get a silhouette picture of a giraffe. I mean, they do stand out quite a bit, and if you're lucky and you get them in an open area with very little vegetation behind them, you can get beautiful silhouettes of a giraffe. So Adrian has asked us a question about how many subspecies of giraffe are there. Now, Adrian, in southern Africa and where we are, we only have one species. It is known as the southern giraffe. That's the species. But then when you go to East Africa, there are a number of species there. And I think, I can't remember exactly, and maybe one of our viewers can help me out with this, but I think there's five or six altogether. So if anybody is watching and can try and find out, but I think there's five or six up in East Africa and North Africa. One of the strangest ones is one called an okapi, which looks like a miniature giraffe, but is part of the giraffe family. And then you have Livingston's giraffe, I think Rothschild's, reticulated, what else? Actually can't remember, so we'll have to try and find out. But that's already four that I've just named there, and I think there's a few more. So Adrian, we'll try and find out exactly how many subspecies there are within Africa. But southern Africa, it's only the one species, just the southern giraffe. Beautiful pattern. Looks like some parasites have got to this giraffe, and all they do is they eat the hair around the giraffe. It doesn't harm them necessarily, and they don't die from it. I've seen it, and also it's very, very clear on older giraffe. You tend to see this happening a lot, these little blotches of these patches of bare skin where parasites have eaten away at the hair, but it doesn't affect them. Beautiful patterns. Get a lot of ticks around the rump in that. I think what we're going to do is maybe continue along and head towards one of the other dams. Pauline and Cedric and Franz just asked me what the bird was behind the giraffe. Was it those little oxpeckers? Like, oh, look at that. Oh, well done, Brian. Look at that. Very, very hot, these little oxpeckers. And they're the birds that sit on the animals and they pick off the ticks. The reason for that is they actually like the blood that obviously the ticks are full of. But these ones are dust bathing. That is wonderful to see. Cleaning the feathers by dust bathing. And these are the red-billed oxpeckers because of that red beak or red bill. The other species we get around here is the yellow-billed, but they are quite rare. And you don't see them very often. That's lovely. Beautiful coloration around that yellow eye and that red beak. So as I said, I think we're going to continue and head towards a waterhole. Another waterhole, treehouse, I think it is. Treehouse waterhole, and while we do that, why don't you cross over to Taylor and see what updates she has for you.
We had the most beautiful sighting of about 10 kudu all crossing the open plains, but they've moved off quite quickly now. And we are left with this one beautiful kudu cow who's feeding quite happily on what looks like a very dwarfed apple leaf, which is the tree that I was telling you about a few minutes ago. And isn't she lovely? How she's using that long neck of hers, that tongue, to reach the top leaves, and it's making for a beautiful silhouette as well, those beautiful big ears. Look at that. And you can see the rest of them and a giraffe in the background as well, having a little feed. There's quite a few different animals out here on quarantine this afternoon. And something that I'm excited for that I have mentioned is the birthing season, because I believe that quarantine becomes littered with all sorts of different animals. Impala, buffalo, wildebeest, zebra, and of course with all their little ones. Isn't that lovely? This is so spectacular. Look at those big ears, and look how they are able to maneuver their neck around like it's almost a piece of bendable wire. I always find that quite amazing as to how flexible the animals really are. And that is so lovely. Perfect opportunity for a little silhouette photo. And even the backlighting on her is absolutely stunning. Look at that. I love that sort of golden sheen on the outside. Look at the, did you see that giraffe as well? How beautifully lit up it was. Off the kudu goes. Where are you going next? Off into the distance. To catch up with the rest of the herd, of course. She doesn't want to get left too far behind. Otherwise, she's going to find herself in a bit of trouble. There's another one. They're all just dispersing here. It's like they're descending on the DRC to go and feed on all the lovely trees that have been untouched in there. Except we have a local bushbuck that comes through and eats all our garden. Look at them now. They're loving the apple leaves. That's another dwarfed apple leaf over there that you're looking at. They are thoroughly enjoying them this afternoon. Now, I wouldn't imagine that their leaves would be too tasty. They've got very, very crunchy leaves. It almost sounds like when you do crunch them in your hand, it sort of does sound a bit like somebody biting into an apple. Maybe I'll be able to find another small one, one that doesn't have kudu attached to it. And I'll be able to let you hear for yourself. Look at that giraffe just in the distance. Now, that marula is in the way. How dare it grow over there? I'm obviously just joking. Isn't that beautiful? Like I said, I think we're going to be in for a real treat with the sunset. It's going to be absolutely spectacular. You can already see that lovely golden light coming through the trees. Hello, kudu. Having a little nibble, and they'll carry on feeding throughout the night. Sometimes they'll have a little rest during the day, but they don't need to have long sleeps like the lions do. And off they go into the distance. But let's quickly go down to the dam. We're not far from there. We're just on quarantine. Let's go have a look and see if there's perhaps anything at the watering hole. Maybe some elephants, maybe a hippo. Now, if you're wondering and you're looking at that kudu, they almost look like camels with that big hump. And I know that Shani was wondering exactly what the function of that hump is. Shani, that's really just a wither like you see in a horse. It doesn't really have too much of a function. It's not like a camel where they store extra fat. It's just really bone, just a wither. Right, I'm gonna go a little bit quicker. Let's quickly head round the corner and see what's down at the dam. I wonder if Henry the hippo is around. I miss him. I haven't seen him for a few. When did I last see Henry? I think I saw him yesterday afternoon when he was being harassed. But I feel as though he's become a part of my life and I need to see him at least once a game drive. And I missed him this morning. Maybe he's there this afternoon. Maybe he's going to get out of the water if he is in there. That would be nice. Right, we're almost there. I can see lots and lots of impala, of course. I can't seem to see any elephants. I think I can see a buffalo in the distance, but I'm not sure just yet. There's lots of trees in the way. Oh, and I can't tell you how refreshing this breeze is now. It's now finally cooled down. I don't have to use my fan anymore. I can just use the wind. Oh, we've got a warthog. Hello, warthog. Now, don't run away at Jigger's squeaky brakes. There's the warthog. beautiful female. She's quite, it looks like quite an old girl. She's got relatively large tusks, and normally the males have got very, very big tusks. And she's munching away. I'm surprised she's also not down on her knees, nibbling away. It'd be a lot easier, seeing as that grass is so short, and you can see she's quite happy to have the company of the impala around her. And if I was a warthog, I think I would hang around with the impala and the zebra all day long, just because their senses are much better than that of a warthog. I have actually, in fact, snuck up to a warthog. I got within 2 meters of one, which is a little bit silly of me, but it was on a big open area, and I had the wind in my favor, and I had the sun in my favor, and this warthog didn't even know I was there. And I just thought, well, it would just be interesting to see what it does. So I went, and of course the warthog popped its head up from it as it was eating, and it was on its knees and stood up and looked in front of it and scanned, and then he turned around and faced me and went, oh my goodness, and got the fright of his life, and he trotted off a little bit. And then I thought, well, I better get out of there in case he decides to change his mind and charge me. So that was quite a nice little experiment, just to test the warthog's senses. Now, I'm sure you saw that little fence in the distance. That's just a fence that goes around the lodge to try and prevent things like leopards and lions and elephants going in there and bulldozing their way through. However, it doesn't stop the antelope. The antelope will jump straight over the top of that. They've got very springy springs to their step, as you've seen with the impala. And the nyala can jump fairly well too. But let's go down and see who else is at the dam. I don't see anyone just yet. Let's see, no, just some impala by the looks of it. Henry, are you there? I'm having a little look to see if I can see Henry. Yes, let's go say hello to Henry. I miss him lots. I don't think he misses me quite as much as I miss him though. If only he knew how I really felt about him. Hello, impala. Lots of them around. You can see the little dots of orange. Oh, the flies are really being pests today. They're trying to go up my nose. Hello, impala. You guys are not running away from me. That's unusual. Look at them. This is completely bizarre. We've only had the impala racing away from us all the time, and these are sort of doing more of a casual stroll away. I feel less offended when they do this. But perhaps that they're just so hungry that they aren't too bothered by us at all. Having a lovely feed. Right, let's get to Henry and say a quick hello to him. You've always got to look both ways, even though I am out in the wilderness. You never know who may be crossing the road next. He's heard me. I think he can hear me coming, obviously. Let's give him a little bit of room, though. I don't know if the camera's working, but I'm going to wave to it. Hi, everyone. Hi, Henry. Henry's giving me the death stare. That's not the kind of welcome I expected from you, Henry. Oh, no. Here you go, you can see his eye just creeping up. No, why are you rolling forward, Jigger? Let me just try and get Jigger to sit still. Say, there we go. Have a look at on that oxpecker on Henry's back. Oh no, Henry's got a wound of some sort. And now this oxpecker is unfortunately aggravating it. You can see it's trying to peck at that fresh wound to get the blood to stimulate and to ooze out. And that's what the oxpecker is doing. I know we've all said this a few times, but I know there's a few new viewers here. The oxpeckers are great at removing the parasites, which is works perfectly for the various species of animals, but unfortunately they can be a bit of a pest. Now, I'm not sure what's gone on Henry's back, but perhaps he was chomped by another hippo bull. Maybe he got into a bit of an argument. bit difficult to see exactly what's going on. It looks like it's quite a big wound that he's got. Look, doesn't look particularly too fresh, but maybe the oxpeckers that have been landing on him throughout the day have opened it up for him. But he looks all right. He seems quite happy and content. Hello, Mr. Blacksmith Lapwing, if you are a he. They are also always around the dam. I suspect that they have a nest somewhere nearby. You don't seem too bothered at us, not shouting at us, not shouting at the impala or the hippo. Normally they get quite cranky when anybody is anywhere near their nest, and they make a ridiculous noise and try and mob and dive bomb anything that gets too close. But I'm glad that you seem very happy on this lovely Saturday afternoon. Where's Mrs. Lapwing? I can't see Mrs. Lapwing anywhere. Oh, Henry, that wasn't very nice. You scared Mr. Lapwing away. He saw that big snort that was sort of a bit like a sprinkler coming out of his nose. And now he's gone back to sleep again. You've got lots of mud on you still. And I'm sure it won't be too long before Henry decides to get out of the water and go for something to eat. Now, we're seeing... my voice decided to do something quite bizarre there. We've seen quite a few watering holes today, and I know Melinda was wondering, are these natural or are they man-made? We've got a combination of both. So this particular one that we were looking at that Henry is in, this one is pumped with water. But if we go down to the little pan in the distance, you see that? That is a natural pan. We don't pump any water in there. That is what's left after the rain that we had. The same thing with Biffle's Hook Pan, and I'm pretty sure with a treehouse dam. And twin dams, is that also natural? I don't think any of those are pumped down there. There's not very much. They've been constructed, yes, like VM says, but it's just natural water that's falling into them. And of course, the mud wallows are really helpful during the summer months when we do get a bit of rain, because they fill up quite nicely and form like little watering holes themselves. Now, you can see that the wind is picked up quite nice. You can actually see how the water is blowing just on the surface. That's not from Henry. You can see those little ripples there, which is good. Now, I don't see... Oh, there's a threatening cloud in the distance. Look at that cumulonimbus cloud slowly building. Can you see that? There we go. That's a little bit better. Now, that's a very typical cumulonimbus cloud. They start forming vertically, and they get bigger and bigger and sort of get an anvil shape to them. And normally then, when they get big enough, you hear the rumbling of the thunder, and then of course you see the lightning in between the clouds. But I don't think that cloud on its own, unfortunately, is going to bring a bit of a storm, so I think we need more. And from behind us, it looks very clear so far, a bit hazy. A little bit hazy, but not any big clouds like we would want. Isn't that beautiful? I think we need to get back to quarantine. I think we need to have a little look at the sunset. What do you think, Viam? I think it's going to be quite spectacular. So thank you, Henry. It was lovely seeing you again. Oh, I've seen some monkeys, and I think they're going to go for a drink. Let's get a little bit closer. Let's have a little look here. There's a monkey, little vervet monkey. There was a few of them. They're all coming running down now. That's when you know it's hot, when the monkeys are racing towards the water to get a drink. I've decided I'm not going to go onto the dam wall, because I would like to try and show you the sunset this evening. And if I do that, then I'm going to go very far away. Also edging on the side of caution as they approach the watering hole. And I don't think the vervet monkeys appreciate mud as much as the rest of them. And a little hummercop in the middle of your screen. That's a nice bird to have a look at. Look at the monkeys on the left. They can't decide on a pathway to get to some good water. And Aaron, New Zealand, you got your wish. I believe that you were hoping to see a hummercorp, the bird that makes some of the largest nests in the world. Well, there you go. And what a great shot that is with the backdrop of some vervet monkeys. Isn't that very nice? having a quick little drink, the Vervies. My... not my favourite animal. Oh, look! We've got a hardy-dar, South Africa's most annoying bird, coming down to have a drink as well. Even the annoying ones, I suppose, get a little bit thirsty. Beautiful. Well, it seems as though I don't need to worry about chasing after the sunset this evening. It's like Byron has... well, Byron and I, think, have got a bit of telepathic connection. Let's go have a look at his beautiful African sunset.
I think there might be a bit of a connection there, Taylor. That's right. As you said, you were possibly going to look for the sunset. We came and found it. And look at that. It really is beautiful. Magnificent sunset. And another few minutes, and that's going to disappear behind the Drakensberg mountain range. You might be able to see it. Yeah, just through there. But it's just really wonderful to sit here, listen to the birds, and watch that sunset. So peaceful and just so beautiful. You can hear that whistle behind us. That was a red-crested koran whistling behind us. A lot of birds giving their last calls of the day as the sun sets. Look, some clouds forming a little bit, nothing too serious. But look at you can actually see the sun rays through there. That's wonderful, really beautiful. And I always say it's nice to have clouds in the sky when you have a sunset, because you get all those wonderful colors and you get to see those rays. You can see it really clearly through there. Look at that. So quiet, so peaceful, just absolutely wonderful. Those colors, it's really starting to get very orange now in the sky, with those sun rays beaming through the clouds. Wow, look at that color. That's very, very beautiful. You can see just starting to dip behind that mountain range, the Drakensberg. You can see it very clearly now, the outline of that mountain, or of those mountains. And there you see the tip of the sun. And that's going to drop very quickly now behind there. We'll see, I think we'll give it till about halfway. And then we'll carry on going and see what else we can find. I've been told that I've got some challenges for our evening drives. And one of them is a chameleon. See if we can find some chameleon in the next few days. And Debbie has just mentioned that she is wondering when we are going to see the first chameleon of the summer. They tend to hibernate in the winter, as reptiles do, and especially because it's so very dry, you don't see many of them. But, you know, we had a bit of rain recently. Maybe we're lucky and we find some chameleons out. Not always easy to spot, but we will try our best. That is lovely. Wow, fantastic. Let's carry on moving a bit with that sunset in the background. See with the last little bit of light if we can't find anything before we use the spotlight. Oh, elephant, straight ahead. There we go. What a nice surprise. We've got the elephant and the sunset. Let's just see if it's by itself. I doubt it. It looks like a young elephant. Let's just have a look around here. I'm just going to creep a little bit closer. This is quite interesting. It does appear to be by itself. Oh no, I actually thought I heard some elephant in the distance off to our right. So opposite direction to where this elephant is now. Definitely thought I heard some elephant communication going on there. So Melinda has asked us a question about how long elephants can live. Melinda, on average, elephants out in the wild can live to about 50 or 60 years old, which is very old for these wild animals. Oh, look at that. Really enjoying the branches there. So, Melinda, I hope that answers your question. You know, about 50 to 60 years old. And as I said, that's really old. And the theory is that the elephant would actually live a lot longer if they were able to feed more. But by the time they get to that age, what happens is the elephant actually go through sets of teeth throughout their lifetime. And as they get worn down, new sets grow in place. Or a new set grows in place. The thing is, with the elephant, they go through six sets. So by the age of about 55, 60, it's their last set. And once that's worn out, they struggle to feed and they usually die from natural causes, then, you know, just not getting enough food, nutrients, and old age. It's amazing. As they move, they're just constantly feeding. You can imagine, to keep that big bulk going and efficient, they need all the food they can get. They need the nutrients. So they're bulk feeders. They'll feed and feed and feed. A large elephant can feed on up to almost 200, 250 kilograms of food a day. So that's a lot of vegetation. Oh, look at that. That's really spectacular to see him feeding. Watch the trunk constantly moving around, working, breaking branches. They use it for everything. It is incredible. And there's a fork-tailed drongo in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, just behind the elephant. And that's interesting, because what that little bird is possibly doing is, while the elephant is moving around feeding, it's disturbing a lot of insects. And that fork-tailed drongo is waiting so that it may possibly catch a few of these insects that are being disturbed as the elephant moves through. Oh, that's really fantastic. Wasn't that a nice surprise? So we've got a question from Stuff Is So Cool. Again, I'm assuming it's your Twitter handle. And they would like to know if elephants ever step on their trunks. No, I've never seen it happen, and I highly doubt that an elephant will go and step on its trunk. The trunk, even though they can lower it down and touch the ground, when they're actually walking, it doesn't get in between or underneath the feet. So chances of them standing on it are highly unlikely. I've never seen it happen. I've never heard of it happening. So no, I don't think they would. And also, they're very careful. They're always vigilant of where the trunk is, and they use it for feeding while they're walking. So it's always doing something. It's not going to get caught under the feet. That elephant's moved off. I think we're going to do the same. Just going to have a look around and see if we don't see more of them. And like I said, I thought I heard something in the distance. Let's just have a look just before we start getting the spotlights out. There's that big cloud that I heard Taylor speaking about earlier, that cumulonimbus cloud in the distance forming. And that is definitely a rain cloud, but it's a bit too far. We need it closer, and we need more of them. Really lovely afternoon. We got to see all the lions, we got to see elephant, buffalo, leopard. So Yale from Washington has asked us an interesting question about the various trees. Oh, there's a little lapwing. It's running a, and that's an interesting one. That's a Senegal lapwing. Hang on, there we go. Oh, that's not one you see very often. That's called a Senegal lapwing. Off it goes. That's a nice surprise. I don't think I've ever seen them in this area. There's another one there too. So just getting back. Sorry, I just got a whiff of something. I thought I could smell elephant. I don't see anything just yet. Let's carry on. But getting back to Yale's question on the buffalo thorn, Yale asked, you know, I mentioned earlier how sharp those trees are, the thorns of those trees are, and they can easily draw blood if you touch them or handle them. And Yale asked, are there other trees that have sharp thorns that will, you know, do some damage like that and draw blood? Yes, there are a number of trees, Yale. There's a number of different acacia species. Now, some of the acacia trees we have, so the entire acacia family within southern Africa or within Africa have got thorns, and the different species of them, some of them have got sharp, long, white thorns, and others have got shorter hook thorns, which are also very, very sharp. So a lot of those, if you get, if you run into them or step on them, they can cause some serious damage, and they can cause a bit of pain. I'm sure I heard an elephant. Perhaps it's hiding under a rock. A lovely cool breeze now that we can feel while we're driving. Checking my spotlight works. Yep. I'm going to have to get used to the multitasking. I spoke about it last time I was here, shining the spotlight, talking, driving the vehicles. Hopefully I'm a bit better at it this time. While we carry on driving around, why don't we cross over to Taylor and get an update from her and see what she has found.
It seems as though everybody's coming down for one last drink this evening at the Pan. I think we're going to have to reposition again. It looks like the Impala are moving in, the Inyala is moving in, and a couple of guinea fowl that are chasing each other as well on the bottom right-hand side of your screen. They seem to be having a little bit of a domestic. Now, this is the equivalent of a South African chicken, however much prettier than the normal chicken, but their mannerisms are very much the same. The way that they chase each other around and peck through the leaf litter and scrape with their feet, especially when they get the dung. But I absolutely love those beautiful bright blue heads that they have. And of course, we've got an impala doing its business. Oh, what is that found? A little insect of some sort that guinea fowl was chasing. Not quick enough, I think. That insect perhaps got away. But I'm very impressed at their turning capabilities. That one almost did a 180 right on the spot. And off they go. I wonder if they're going to go around and have a little drink as well. There we go. Favorite thing of a guinea fowl to do, is to peck in the elephant dung. And that's normally when we find it being scraped over. Oh, very territorial about that elephant poop. The one on the left is telling the one on the right, you better get moving. And now they're both running away, so nobody won. That was a bit disappointing. Let's see. I think we wonder if Mr. Inyala over there, who's a beautiful specimen, is going to have a drink. Or perhaps he's eyeing out those female that you can see in the distance. That could also be what he's doing. He looks like he's got a bit of a limp to him, don't you think? Let's see when he walks. He doesn't look to be seem to be walking quite soundly. Maybe he's had a little run-in with a bigger Inyala bull and is feeling a little bit stiff today. Yes, you can see he doesn't seem 100% sound. Those elephants that we could hear, Viam and I both looked at each other and we're certain that we heard some elephants not too far from here. Let's go around and see if we can quickly relocate on them. Before we lose all the light. The sun is disappearing quite quickly this evening and I'm blind from the presenter light. My eyes have to adjust to the bright light that is now sitting behind me. Hey, we've even got a waterbuck. I haven't seen any waterbuck today. Let's go stealth mode. We're going to roll over to Madam Waterbuck. Please don't run away. Hello. And she looks like she's got quite a stomach on her. Are you pregnant? Look at that big bulging belly. Perhaps there's a young waterbuck inside you and you're on your own. Where's the rest of your friends and family? That's all right, we'll keep you company for a little bit. Trying desperately to get those last of the green grass shoots. Now you can see why we actually really need the rain, so we can get some moisture down to the roots so it can keep pushing up those beautiful, nutritious blades of grass. You may even be able to hear her eating if you turn your volume up. She's not making as much noise as I was hoping, but she was just trying to listen very quickly. I'm hearing something in the distance. Let's go and investigate. Let's leave the elephants. It sounds like a distress call of something. I don't know where it is, but I'm going to turn my radio on very quickly. Let me find out what's happening with the lions. Can anybody give me an update on the Nkuhumas? Sorry, I don't know why I actually did that, Fiam. Confirm they're bumbering in Yari. Is there any opportunity to come and join that sighting? I'm just getting onto Central. Thank you. Just confirm whereabouts. Hold on, everyone. Copy. I'll be there shortly. Right. The lions are making a kill. We could hear the buffalo distress calling in the distance. We need to get there as soon as we can. So we're going to race on over. So please excuse the way that I'm about to drive, but I know that you want to see this. Now we're a little bit far away and I need to try and get to this sighting as quick as possible. Let's go back to Byron and I'm going to try and get to those lions as quick as possible.
That sounds amazing. Taylor's on her way to look for those lions and hopefully she finds them. But that's incredible. Earlier when we were with that, we saw that herd of buffalo. And remember I said they were heading in the direction of Biffleshook Dam. And the more we drove closer towards the dam, there were so many buffalo spread out over that whole area. So I think it's possibly lions that were around there, the Nkuhuma pride, maybe those buffalo, which is very interesting. I'm trying to see if I can find any nocturnal wildlife, and especially a chameleon. We've had a lot of requests for chameleons. So let us see. Let's see what we can find. And it's not always easy. Sorry, we're just passing some people, but it's not always easy now this time of the evening. We're using the spotlight, but it's not dark enough for us to really see anything. Good evening, everyone. Hello, hi. So what we're trying to do is just wait for it to get a little bit darker and then use the spotlight a bit, and we'll see if we can't find something. Getting there slowly but surely. Like I said, time for the multitasking to come out. Welcome to Gracie, who's age nine, and Gracie said thank you to the new guy. Thank you, Gracie. It's lovely to be here. My name is Byron. Lovely to meet you. I haven't seen the baby elephant yet. I think it was Taylor saw it yesterday, but I haven't seen it yet, but I am looking around for these baby elephants that I've heard so much about. And a very happy birthday to your mom. I believe it's her birthday today. And that's Jennifer. Happy birthday, Jennifer. Hope you have a wonderful day. And it's, for those of you who follow the show regularly, it is James's birthday tomorrow. So we'll all be sending him birthday wishes while he's on his leave. I'm sure he's enjoying it, relaxing, possibly drinking some of that apple juice he loves so much. It's a little giraffe. Remember I spoke about trying to get those silhouettes of these giraffes when the light is right. And if you were a photographer, you could actually get a lovely silhouette now. Off it goes. Oh, that giraffe looks like it's got a little bit of a limp. Actually, the back left leg seems a little bit stiff and walking with a bit of a limp. So that old giraffe could potentially fall prey to lions. So I thought I saw something move over there. No. Okay, so we've lost a bit more light now. So now it's ideal to try and find these little creatures of the night, little chameleons, maybe a little scorpion or two if we're lucky. There's some kudu crossing the road. Peggy's asked us an interesting question. She would like to know if there are any serval in the area. Peggy, there definitely are serval around here. I just have not seen serval, but not in this area where we are now, not in Juma, but just south of here, not too far. On another property, I've seen serval down there. So there are serval within the Sabi Sands and within the Kruger, within the greater Kruger. Just a case of trying to find them. Not always easy. Okay, come on. Let's see if I can find the first chameleon of the season. Or a honey badger. Remember I mentioned this morning, all I want to see again is a honey badger. Haven't seen one for quite a while, so that would be lovely. Scan. scanning. Those of you who are wondering what's going on with Taylor, she's still just trying to get into the area where she heard those lions and buffalo and all that interaction, and potentially where the lions are trying to kill the buffalo. They're so opportunistic, those lions. Even though they fed on one last night or yesterday, because the buffalo are around, they will still try and hunt them. Yeah, no luck just yet, Brian. A lot of impala and that all out in the clearing. We're just driving around quarantine at the moment. And with it becoming a lot darker now, a lot of animals come out into these open areas for safety. And try and rely on the open areas to warn and alert each other if there is potential danger or a threat around. And that way, also being out in the open, they can see them coming a lot easier and they can then move away. I'm looking very carefully with the spotlight because I'm looking for specific things. I'm looking for the chameleons, I'm looking for a scorpion if I can find one for you. Sorry, impala, don't want to shine on the impala. The lights are a little bit bright for them. It would also be lovely to see a little bush baby. I know last time I was there we did see, and I know I remember seeing a clip of Jamie had a lot of luck with some bush babies poking their heads out of a little hole a while ago. Come on. Oh, this is perfect light now. It's really getting fairly dark, so the spotlight will be working a lot better now in this light. I haven't seen any bats flying around yet. I'm looking for them though. I used to work with a tracker. We worked together for about 5 years. And I learned so much from him, especially with nocturnal wildlife and finding them, because he could spot incredibly well. His name is Judas, and Judas used to spot little chameleons. And when I say baby chameleons about that size, honestly, I could not believe how he found them. He'd often spot snakes in trees, like the boomslang, which are quite nocturnal, active at night. He'd spot them around. So it was always great driving with him in the evenings, and he really taught me a lot on how to spot different nocturnal wildlife at night. It doesn't look like it, and I haven't found anything yet, but we are trying. So Sally has asked me a question, and Sally would like to know, where and how do you become training to be a safari guide? Well, Sally, just about anybody can do it. And within South Africa, every country's got slightly different laws and assessments and exams that you need to pass to become a guide. Within South Africa, though, you can do it all correspondence and self-study. You can go, generally what they try and do is they recommend that you go on a course somewhere first, so you get some practical experience while you are studying. And those courses range from anywhere from about 6 months up to a year. There are some shorter 2 or 3 month courses that you can do. And once you've done that, you then write an exam, and once you pass the exam, you then have to be practically evaluated, and then after all of that, you're then legal to guide within South Africa. There are a few other odds and ends that you have to do, but generally that's how you do it, through a company known as the Field Guide Association of South Africa. And the FGAS, or Field Guide Association, is the company we register through to get our qualifications. But speaking about that, it sounds like Taylor has got to those lines, so get to her quickly. Oh, sorry, I think she's just repositioning her vehicle, it sounds like it. Hold on a second and let her get into position before you cross over. I'm still trying to find the elusive chameleon. I think Taylor has managed to get her vehicle in position now. I think it's going to be all from myself and Brian this evening. Brian, thank you very much, and the thumb. And we will see you tomorrow morning on our morning safari. Thank you to everyone in Final Control. Go over, see what Taylor's got and what the lions are up to. We'll see you tomorrow. Good night.
Isn't this incredible? Apparently the Nkuhumas very quickly got up and caught this buffalo. It is unbelievable. That's what I heard, distress calling in the distance. And apparently they killed this buffalo very quickly, which is unusual because we've seen how long it can take them. Perhaps it was an older buffalo that was quite weak and on its way out anyway. But this is fantastic. Now, unfortunately, we won't be able to stay here for too long because the sun is disappearing. It is getting very dark. And of course, these cubs are very young still to be spotlighted when it gets completely dark. But luckily, we are able to have a very quick look, and it's definitely something that we'll be able to follow up on in the morning. But I'm sure you are all jumping for joy that the Nkuhumas managed to get another buffalo, and they will have another day that they can feast on a beautiful piece of beef. Isn't this beautiful? Look at the little ones trying to tuck in, trying to rip through that skin, but again, their teeth, everything is not strong enough just yet. We're just very quickly getting a spotlight. Mine doesn't seem to be working very well. Oh no, really, don't worry. So we're just gonna have a look. It's okay, I'll use these other guys' spotlight. They can shine on for us. It's alright. Yeah, it's perfect. No problem. Thank you so much. We're just trying to organize another spotlight yet. No, it's okay. Thank you so much. Have a lovely drive. We're going to get back to the action now. We're just going to wait for another vehicle to get in. And unfortunately, we don't have any infrared, and that's why we won't be able to stay with them for too long and spot on these cubs. But you can see them there. But we'll have one last little look. It's going to be a few months still until these little ones are able to have the full brunt of a spotlight. But we know that at least they're going to be here first thing in the morning. And I'm sure they're going to feast on this buffalo for a while. It looks like quite a big buffalo, perhaps a cow. It doesn't seem to be big enough to be a bull. And I hope that you are enjoying this. We're just going to get another vehicle come past us very quickly. Yeah, if you'd like to go past, you're more than welcome to. We're just going to let this other vehicle come through very quickly. They're just going to pass us to get into a better spot. They've obviously, it's a very tricky spot here. There's lots of fallen trees around, so we've got to be quite careful moving around at night. We will have another look now. And you can see them moving around. Some of them having a rest, not quite ready to start eating just yet. Isn't this beautiful? Here we go. Need all the dust that's settling from the cubs jumping around all the time. And practicing what their parents do by jumping. Even though this buffalo is dead, it's important that they practice these techniques. Look at that one. It's having a sleep on the back of the buffalo now. It's gone, I'm exhausted, right? I'm done for the day now. I'm just going to have a nap. Big yawn. And that would be a nice, soft, comfy spot to have a rest. Ooh, careful, you're going to roll off the top of that buffalo if you're not careful. All of the little ones trying to tuck in quite nicely. Look at how their eyes light up. What an amazing way to end the day. Me driving like a crazy person to get here just to show you a couple of minutes of the Nkuhumas on the buffalo. But like I said, we're going to come back here first thing tomorrow morning to come and have a look and see how full the Nkuhumas' bellies are. Now, unfortunately, that's almost the end for us. We are going to have to leave soon. Like I said, I'm not really wanting to shine a light too much more on these little cubs just because they're not quite long enough. But let's have one last look to get your Nkuhuma fix for the night. And it's been an absolute pleasure once again. But I'm going to leave you with these magnificent creatures as they start to devour this buffalo. And I hope you've enjoyed the show. And I look forward to tomorrow morning. Have a lovely evening wherever you may be. We'll see you for the sunrise drive.